I would like to welcome today members who are participating by video conferencing in order to assist with the social distancing guidelines here in the room. And this morning we are joined by Paula Bradshaw and Colin McGrath at this point, and we may be joined by other members. Can I also remind all members about the protocols regarding the use of electronic devices? Members, we have received no apologies today, and are members aware of any apologies? No. Okay. Moving on, members, then, to chairperson's business. We have another double meeting today to continue consideration of evidence from our inquiry into care homes. I just want to advise members that I met with Niamh Louise, which is a mental health charity in the Dungannon area. I have received a number of letters from young people who the charity work with, setting out some of their concerns, and I will circulate those letters to members for consideration, and we maybe give them a mention again. But they are very interesting in that they're coming directly from young people expressing their concerns, and I think they're very worth a read. I have seen some of them at this stage, and they're very informative. And thank you to all the young people who did that for us. We also have our committee motion, which we have agreed, and that is going to be debated on Monday in the chamber, the motion that the committee have put forward. So moving along then, members, to item 3, the draft minutes. I refer you to the draft minutes of the meetings held on the 12th of November, which are tabs 3.1 of your meeting pack. Are members content with those minutes? Yeah, thank you, members. There are no matters arising then today from those minutes either. Departmental briefing then, members, on Brexit. I refer members to papers at tab 5 of the pack and your table papers. And I can advise members that officials from the Department of Health are here today to update the committee on developments with regard to Brexit. So I'd now like to welcome in person. Thank you. So, members, this morning I would like to welcome Ms. Cathy Harrison, who is the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer, Ms. Patricia Quinn Duffy, who is EU Exit Lead, Reciprocal Healthcare and Workforce Issues, Ms. Fiona Taylor, who is UK EU Exit Lead on Medicines, and Fiona is joining us via video link. Sorry, no, Fiona's here. Sorry, Fiona. So Fiona's here in person with us. We are being joined by Mr. Brenton O'Neill, Head of Information Governance, and that will be on computer, on video link, and I do see Brenton has joined us on video. And do we have Emer Smith? Emer Smith is on our video conferencing system also. So Brenton O'Neill is Head of Information Governance, and Emer Smith is Head of Medicines Policy and EU Exit Transition. So good morning, everybody. You're very welcome. Good to see you. Good to see you in person, and thank you for coming along. It is probably easier for all concerned if we can facilitate that, and I appreciate the fact that you have done that. So listen, Cathy, do you want to go ahead and give us your briefing, and we'll take it from there. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks for the opportunity to come today and for facilitating a face-to-face meeting. I think it is better given the size of the brief. We did provide a briefing for the committee, and I hope it was helpful. I'm going to talk very briefly just through that briefing and summarise the key points, and then they will be available for questions. And I've got most of my team here today as well to answer the questions for the committee. A little bit of background to start with. So the UK left the European Union on the 31st of January of this year and moved into a transition period which runs until the 31st of December, and this transition period will not be extended. At this moment in time, the UK government and EU Commission are still involved in negotiations to secure a free trade agreement, and there is a possibility that a full deal may not be agreed by the end of the transition period. And during the transition period, the UK has continued to follow EU law and regulatory processes. But just to remind the committee that that will change from the 1st of January 2021, when the Northern Ireland Protocol to the withdrawal agreement will take effect in Northern Ireland. We have been working on EU exit and EU transition for a number of years, and we have identified a number of potential risks and that cover a broad range of health areas, and I'm going to talk through those now and give you an update from the last time we appeared. So in terms of medicines and medical devices, Northern Ireland is part of a UK-wide medicines supply chain, and also we're part of a national medical supplies contingency programme. That's being led by the Department of Health and Social Care, but with full involvement of the devolved administrations. And the UK-wide contingencies seek to address the primary risk to the healthcare supply chain, which has been identified as disruption to the supply chain at the Short Straits in the English Channel. That could arise as a result of no deal. And during the past 2 years, extensive national plans have been developed to mitigate possible disruption that could arise as a result of no deal. This has resulted in the development of what is known as a multi-layered approach to UK-wide contingencies, and that involves a range of activities that are now ready, and we are actually in the point where these are going to start to be used. Okay. So that includes active support for trader readiness for businesses who trade with the EU. Buffer stocks have been held in the UK of at least 6 weeks stock, additional stock of medicines and additional supplies of other goods. Extra ferry capacity, and also in addition to that, different routes as well, different routes available, and an express freight service as well from the EU. On the 13th of October, the UK government announced that it had signed agreements with four ferry operators to provide capacity equivalent to over 3,000 HGVs per week for the transportation of Category 1 goods. And it's indicated that those contracts will be in place for up to 6 months after the end of the transition period. And Category 1 goods include all of our medical goods, medicines and other medicine supplies. In addition, across the UK, enhanced arrangements are now operating for the surveillance of the whole medical supply chain. And there are associated shortage management systems in place that are now active. MHRA has provided very detailed guidance and a raft of guidance that covers the whole of the UK, with specific guidance for Northern Ireland where needed, and that's available on the UK Gov website. In addition, regulatory flexibilities have been agreed by the MHRA, and that will enable medicines and medical devices to continue to be placed on the market in the UK, including a 2-year standstill period for medicines and a 2.5-year acceptance of CE marks for medical devices. So that's the national contingencies. They really form the basis of our preparedness in Northern Ireland. Going on to talk a little bit more detail about Northern Ireland and the Northern Ireland Protocol. The UK is currently aligned with the EU key for medicines and medical devices. And as I said earlier, this is going to change after transition when Northern Ireland will remain aligned with the EU and Great Britain will not. And there are implications for us in Northern Ireland. Things are going to change in terms of the regulation and supply of our medical goods that will be permanent. So we'll have to approach a new normal in time. At the fourth meeting of the Ireland-Northern Ireland Specialised Committee on the 5th of November, the UK Government and EU Commission reached an agreement to allow the pharmaceutical industry 12 months from the 1st of January 2021 to comply with the new regulatory requirements, which apply only to Northern Ireland and are as a consequence of the Northern Ireland Protocol. And this includes the requirements relating to falsified medicines directive, qualified person batch testing and importation requirements. And this is a critical decision for Northern Ireland and will allow a phase-in period for the pharmaceutical industry and critically allow more time for our wholesaler chains and pharmaceutical industries to make the business decisions they need to adapt their distribution and logistics arrangements. This was considered to be a positive outcome for us, and it's expected to remove or vastly reduce, I should say, the risk of short-term disruption to the medicine supply chain that may have occurred immediately in the aftermath of end of transition period in Northern Ireland. Now, it wasn't our only contingency, and we weren't fully reliant on achieving the 12-month phase-in period. And we also had already secured some legal advice in relation to goods on the market that would have provided another layer of contingency for us should we have needed it, and that would have allowed medicines that were already placed on the market by the end of the transition period to flow without impediment across the UK. And that's something now that we don't think we're going to have to rely on, but it could still be quite useful in some product lines. At this moment in time, we are still working with the Department of Health and Social Care, and particularly we're waiting for much more detail from that decision that was made on the 5th of November. And when that is received, there will be detailed guidance needed for the industry and service. There are still unresolved issues, I have to advise the committee, and we're in a very active period. I told you that the last time, and we have had significant progress, I hope you would agree, since the last time I was here. But we really are still waiting for some critical decisions to be made. And one of the issues, I suppose, that we're very focused on now in Northern Ireland is the whole issue of flow of our goods into Northern Ireland. And medicines are not the only issue, medical products. Of course, you know, it's much wider, and we're actively working across departments now on some of those issues. Moving on from health care supplies to access to health care and workforce. And first of all, the reciprocal health care agreement. And there are a range of areas relevant to access and health care after EU exit, including continued access by UK citizens to emergency health care in the Republic of Ireland. And the Department and the Department of Health in Dublin are working on an enduring reciprocal health care agreement between UK and Ireland. This will not impact on any current North-South health services, which are based on either a Memorandum of Understanding or Service Level Agreement. The Cross-Border Healthcare Directive enables UK citizens to access healthcare in any EU country and to be reimbursed for this care abroad by their home country currently. And at the end of the transition period, this facility will no longer apply in the UK. If someone has already applied to use the Cross-Border Healthcare Directive before the end of transition, their treatment will be honoured for up to 1 year based on certain conditions, and the Department of Health here is considering the policy around application of the principles after the end of transition periods. That's still something we're working on. Citizens' rights provisions. The withdrawal agreement provides a framework for the continued legal residence and rights of EU citizens living in the UK and UK nationals living in the EU at the end of the transition period. And Westminster are coordinating the application of citizens' rights for access to healthcare. Department of Health is working with DHSC to fully understand what the agreement means for EU citizens. In terms of immigration, the committee may be aware that there will be a new points-based system in place from January 2021. And in terms of mutual recognition of professionals' qualifications, citizens' rights agreements are now in place for all current professional registrants and those applying before the end of transition period. And the future arrangements are part of the EU-UK-EU negotiations, so longer-term arrangements are still under negotiation. Important to note that the UK and Ireland have made a commitment within the common travel area that comprehensive measures continue to be in place to allow for the recognition of qualifications. And the UK has provision in place to allow, in the event of no future agreement, that for a period of up to 2 years, all EEA automatically recognised professions will continue to be automatically recognised by the UK. Moving on then, I'm getting close to the end here, Chair, with data transfer. On the issue of data sharing, UK government-led discussions continue on the UK achieving an adequacy decision. And this is this will be an important decision, and it's still working towards. And without that, North-South data sharing for health and social care and public services would be subject to additional scrutiny. I have to say we have arrangements in place already through standard contractual clauses, and they are in place to cover data sharing currently, Chair. And also that further information and more detailed questions on that, if you have them, Brendan would be best placed to answer. Okay, let's hear more about that. I understand you're getting direct briefing from Food Standards Agency, but just for completeness, I did include a few paragraphs on that in the brief, which I'm not going to go into in detail here. And just to update you on where we are with common frameworks, there are four common frameworks relevant to health and social care. progress, they're progressing well, and the department has already shared the framework summary with the committee for blood safety and quality and organs, tissues and cell frameworks, and we expect to update the committee on the other two frameworks shortly. The committee will also be aware there are three other common frameworks that are led by the Food Standards Agency. In terms of the wider legislative programme, the current EU transition legislative programme includes 11 statutory instruments, 6 of which have already been laid and 4 of which will be laid before the end of the year. And there's been an agreement that the Electronic Commerce Directive will be postponed until January 2021. And finally, just an update on terms of what we're doing in terms of guidance. Are in poor readiness within our health and social care providers and organisations. In August last year, we provided very detailed EU exit operational guidance, and we've been able to update that now given the recent developments. And that is currently in the final stages of being approved through the department, and we hope to get that out, hopefully, I'm going to say by the end of this week or early next week. And there's a number of things just that the committee may be interested in terms of how we're going to handle the EU transition. It is upon us. It is happening. So we're very much now moving out of a sort of a planning phase into a response phase. And that's very much the tone that will be in the operational guidance, would be to get ready for leaving and for them to update their plans where needed. Because a lot of the things haven't changed, like we still have the risk of no deal, that was what the basis of their original plans, so we're not anticipating radical changes. And the key principles that we're advising them on are that, first of all, any issues that arise relating to EU exit now in the health service are going to be handled through the incident response structures, battle rhythms, sit reps and emergency response that we've already got in place for COVID-19 that are working very well. And that will allow the HSC organisations to escalate, if they need to, any issues up through sit reps very quickly on a daily basis, and right up to 2 strategic cells that I'm chairing. One is looking at all of our supplies issues, and one is looking at the wider context of EU transition, and that will allow for rapid decision making. Those strategic cells that I'm involved in with my team are linked in with national strategic cells and national planning. Should we need to respond to any unforeseen issues. Obviously, we don't know what's coming, which was best to be prepared and have a plan. Also, we will be advising that extensive national contingencies are in place to ensure healthcare supplies, and that means that the huge amount of work that's going on with the pharmaceutical industry and the wholesalers means that we're not asking frontline services to stockpile or take additional action unless asked to do so, and we're going into a very intense period in the next few weeks of speaking to our stakeholders and to understand specific risks and deal with those in our final stages of planning. Patients and carers can be advised and reassured they don't need to do anything about ordering additional prescription medicines, and prescribers do not need to provide additional quantities of prescriptions. We are asking all our health and social care organisations and providers to put in place enhanced arrangements to monitor their business, as they already have for COVID, and just to be aware of any issues that may arise in relation to EU, and pay particular attention to their supply chains and monitor those. And the department will provide advice where needed on handling any shortages that could arise and to ensure continuity of treatment for patients. So, Chair, thank you very much. That's the end of my briefing, and we're happy now to take questions.
Thank you, and thank you for that very wide-ranging briefing, Cathy. I have to say, it does actually, there is, an increased note of concern around the level of complexity that we're dealing with here. I do, and I did welcome the fact that the medicines issue was addressed by way of additional time, and I think that was important. But that's only one issue. When you hear your briefing there, it's clear that's only one part of one issue of a range, an entire range of issues. I am also, I have to say, genuinely concerned that Brexit is now moving into, it would appear from what you're saying, into an emergency basis on top of COVID that we're already dealing with, in that it's being dealt with through incident response structures. Is it not genuinely fair to say that the health service is already struggling to such a degree with COVID that to add a second major incident and the ongoing incident of Brexit is going to create, potentially push us beyond breaking point in terms of the health service?
Chair, I accept the complexity issue. I think that is correct. Okay, we're dealing with complexity, and it's multifaceted what we're dealing with. My emphasis, I think, for the committee in terms of our preparedness approach here is actually to provide you with assurance, and that is that we already have very good, well-established systems in place here to deal with COVID for the health service. And actually, it's the intention in terms of including EU in those is to avoid additional work for health and social care relating to EU, but to allow any issues that emerge to be rapidly identified and dealt with. So I think what we're doing here is taking a step forward, pragmatic approach, and definitely my intention in all of this planning is not to increase any pressure on health and social care. And the amount of work that is going on in the background, you know, that, I mean, most of the work in relation to the contingencies, particularly in the supplies, and actually all the other areas, is being done away from the front line intentionally. And that's to prevent pressure, additional pressure on those organisations at this time. We're working very closely with all the arm's length bodies, and we'll continue to do that in the coming weeks. I think it is actually helping them. It was welcomed by the arm's length bodies that we weren't setting up a parallel system, and that we would use the existing systems that are tried and tested since March now, and are working well.
Okay, I just want to check, Cathy. Eimear, can you hear us there on the line? And I'm wondering if we can hear you. Can you indicate if you can hear us? Eimear Smith, please. No, we don't seem to be, so IT can maybe just look into seeing can we get Eimear onto the line, but we'll continue on ahead, and if there's any questions that are specific to Eimear, maybe you can go back to them. So in light of that overarching concern, Cathy, are there any other areas that you are currently recommending we seek additional time and extended time similar to the medicines issue?
I suppose I'll ask Patricia in case there's anything on her side, but on the supply side, no. I'm looking for the confirmation now from the European Commission on the detail of the decision around the 12 months, and that was a major decision. That was a major decision, and also we had requested it, you know, some months ago because I had referred to it. So with that assurance and the detail of that, I would be. That they're major steps forward, Chair. They really are for us.
But you and I have been discussing since, I think, probably July, August, a year ago, other related issues around qualifications, around the supply of isotopes. And I know that we have had some stakeholders, including the Royal College of Radiologists and Diabetes UK, have recently expressed concerns about contingency plans for imported isotope supplies. So those are equally concerning, and do they equally require a robust framework put in place to protect our population here?
So medical radioisotopes are short-life products that can't be stockpiled, and they're received into the health service in Northern Ireland, and they're used sometimes on the same day, Chair. So this was one of the areas we looked at. We looked at as part of our planning, possibly over a year ago, and Northern Ireland benefits from having all of our radioisotopes flown in, and what I can assure you is that has been reviewed again in recent months, and we are assured that those systems are robust. There's no concern in that area there's no concern in that area. So we've been through it in the past and also revisited it recently, Chair. So on that issue, there is no additional ask, if you like. You're asking about the big asks. Those big asks were for the European Commission, and they were significant to secure for us. Other things like medical radioisotopes were operational matters that we could handle, and we have handled them.
Okay. And I want to get to members, I suppose. I do have another couple of questions, but hopefully get back to those. But you said that legal advice had been taken about ensuring the flow without impediment, and I'm very conscious that we are talking about a buffer stock which is held somewhere in Britain, and the additional problems with the short straits that we've already identified could come in again. It's also a very complex supply chain in terms of temperature control and issues like that. And I'm also deeply conscious that these issues are as a result of Brexit. You know, the desire for Britain to leave the European Union are leaving us with these problems. But you said legal advice had been taken which ensured that flow of goods without impediment. Is that legal advice related to the Internal Markets Bill, which had set out the case that Britain was prepared to break the law?
No, this was a legal interpretation of Article 41 of the Withdrawal Act, and it related to goods on the market. And the advice that we received in it was that goods on the market, so medicines that were placed on the market by the 31st of December, could continue to flow across the UK. So that was an important interpretation of the law for us, because what that meant was if we hadn't secured the additional 12-month phase-in period, that we wouldn't have had an immediate crisis in terms of our medicine supply chain, and that medicines would have been able to flow. It may still be useful to us in some, because the medicine supply chain, there's so many products involved, but may still be useful to us because we have 12 months for the pharmaceutical industry now to respond to the compliance with the Northern Ireland Protocol. And you know, there could still be instances where we might need to use that legal interpretation, Chair. But that has nothing to do with the Internal Markets Bill.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm going to go to members. So I have Pam. I have Pam on the phone first.
I think some members are having difficulty with Starlift just at the moment, Chair.
Okay, so I'll come to members in the room then, and we'll come back to when we see the screens. Spotlight operating again. So I'm going to move on. So I'm going to go then to Jonathan.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Cathy, for the wide-ranging brief. I suppose probably there's a number of questions right across the board that we could ask in this, and I suppose some of the briefing later on will cover even included the legislative consent motion. I don't know whether to direct those
Sorry,
questions.
Sorry, Jonathan, just a second.
Sorry, I'm advised we need to suspend the meeting briefly to restore the Starleaf.
Okay.
Okay, so we're going to suspend. Okay, thank you, members. We're back in session. Just before I go back to Jonathan, you had said, Cathy, that there was an issue that you maybe would check with Paula in relation to workforce, if there was any from her side of things that needed. Could we just pick up on that before we go?
Most of the workforce issues are really already captured predominantly in the withdrawal agreement. So a lot of the issues originally had been around the sort of the ability to maintain and recognise qualifications in a no-deal scenario. So the withdrawal agreement sets that anyone that is already here or has applied beforehand is able to maintain the recognition of their qualifications. The UK has laid legislation which will allow unilaterally that anyone with an automatically recognised qualification for up to 2 years to have that qualification recognised. So if we have any Europeans coming into Northern Ireland after January, particularly in healthcare, doctors and nurses are automatically recognised. It means that those qualifications will continue to be. So what is going to be different is that the general assessment of qualifications will be different. So, say for example, social workers would have gone through the general assessment. They will now have to go through the assessment that the rest of the world nationals would have to go through for registration. Obviously, the recognition of professional qualifications is still part of the negotiations, so there may still be a negotiated outcome that is different to that, but there is a contingency in place. We are obviously speaking to our Irish counterparts in terms of the cross-border services. Obviously, healthcare cooperation is something that is very important and has been well established, and to ensure that those continue.
Okay, and apologies, I should have said Patricia, of course. So I get it that, again, there's a partial fix in place, and that's welcome as far as it goes. Would you be concerned that will provide a chill factor in terms of us competing to attract in that much-needed staff, that people say, well, mm-hmm. I might be okay for 2 years, do I want to take a chance on that I'm going to be okay beyond that point? Given how hard it is in the world market in that sense of staff, have you concerns on that?
There haven't been any concerns raised around the qualifications. in terms of attracting staff. Obviously, we're in a very different environment with COVID in attracting staff. But the UK government have put in place additional factors around immigration currently, where health and care staff can apply through a health and care visa, which is a shorter, quicker route to become to get a work visa to work in health and social care. They've also waivered the immigration health surcharge for health and social care staff. So that again makes it slightly more attractive. And the Europeans coming after January who will have to apply through that process, it means that there's a level playing field that they don't have to pay an immigration health surcharge, which they would in other professions. So it's slightly more attractive for health and social care professions than it would be for, say, other professions post 31st of December.
Okay, thank you. So I'll go to Jonathan. I will then go to Pam on the phone and back into the room. So I'll go to Jonathan.
Thank you, Chair, and again, maybe second time lucky, but firstly, thanks very much for your presentation. I suppose, firstly, the joint agreement on the time extension for the phased implementation of the Falsified Medicines Directive and batch testing is welcome news and certainly will give businesses some reassurance and they have time to maybe prepare for what is to come. However, it still is unclear whether this will fully mitigate against the risks of declarations of tariffs from the 1st of January on some medicines moving between GB and NI. And could I please put on record, and I know this will be the intention, but it is imperative now that the Department of Health should be using this grace period agreed to press the UK government to ramp up the case for mutual recognition between the EU and the UK in the area in the medium to long term. I think that's essential. We've got a great grace period now, but we need to use that to best effect. Over the course of this past week or so, Chair, I have been engaging with some GB suppliers in the medicine field, and there is the real concern that the economic threat of GB firms no longer seeing Northern Ireland as attractive or viable market from 2022, that will cause significant pressure on supply chains. So perhaps maybe you could outline would the shift in supply chains or potential shift pose risks or problems for our health service? I'd also just like to say, in relation to the cross-border element, the uncertainties and clarity and the way forward, that the fact that Northern Ireland is going to be tied to the EU regime on medicines and a vast range of products, yet aren't even able to access cross-border healthcare under EU directive after the transition period, highlights that the protocol is certainly not the best of both worlds, as some people were championing. Northern Ireland consumers and patients have got a raw deal. So is there a risk that when the agreed medicines derogation ends in 2022, that the friction between trade moving from GB to NI will ultimately lead to local hospitals and pharmacies sourcing products from the Republic and indeed also the rest of the EU, hence putting pressure on existing supply chains?
Thank you, Mr. Berkeley. So the 12 months is a significant step forward. Okay, the pharmaceutical industry asked for it, and they see it as an opportunity to put in place measured sort of changes in terms of their supply and logistic arrangements. The pharmaceutical industries, there isn't a single approach that they use even currently in terms of their supply chains. And in our conversations with them, and I've been meeting with individual companies and also part of national meetings, my understanding is there's a range of options that they are considering in terms of what their long-term and more the new normal would look like for Northern Ireland. And that some of those options, if they had to be rushed, yes, we could have been in a much more risky position than we are now. The 12 months is really significant. Now, some of the companies are telling me 12 months isn't a long time. And what I'm doing is I'm working with Department of Health and Social Care to make sure now that we're not stopping. We're not stopping this work. All the work that has been going on in recent months is going to continue now. And we're going to continue at a pace in terms of working with industry to understand what's your preferred model. The number of different models that I can describe if you are interested, and that they are considering. Those models ultimately will be business decisions that they'll make. What My goal here is that we will have continued access to all the medicines we have at the moment, and that our patients in Northern Ireland and us as citizens have equity of access to all new medicines and other medicines in the future. So that's how we're entering those talks with DHSC. They know that, and they know that that's where we're starting with in terms of our negotiation with the pharmaceutical industry. And my engagement with the pharmaceutical industry has been very, very positive. There are issues, Mr. Buckley, you're right, they now will have more time to work through those, and they will have government support as well for this if needed. But I don't think we're going to have a switch from one system where we have now onto one single system.
Okay, and is there an attempt now via the department and indeed the Northern Ireland Executive as a whole to basically use this grace period as an attempt now to further engage both with central government and the EU Commission as to mutual recognition? Because I think that in itself will pose the best route to ensure security of supply for medicines.
Okay, so the mutual recognition agreement is still under consideration. It is something that the pharmaceutical industry are very, very keen to secure. Yeah. It's important for them. It does not address the issues relating to the Northern Ireland Protocol. So we, in terms of the need for falsified medicines directive and a qualified person checks. It doesn't remove that issue.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. And maybe you could forward us the models rather than going into detail. The you said there's information on the various models.
There's not that much. I'm happy to say what they are, Chair. There's three options. There's not detailed modelling done at this stage.
Okay. I'll move on then. I'm going back on the phones there to Paula Bradshaw. Paula, are you there, please?
Good morning, and thank you very much for the presentation. I was just going to follow on from your question, Colm, about the healthcare professionals coming into Northern Ireland, and I appreciate that some of the immigration issues are very much the UK government responsibility, but I'm just wondering, because health has devolved, if there are any measures we can put in place to actually make working in Northern Ireland more attractive. So that's my first question. And the second question relates to the cross-border healthcare directive. You've said there that the report, the Department of Health is considering the policy around the application of the principles post end of the transition period. I'm just wondering, since we're about 6 weeks off the end of the year, how soon will we see the outworkings of that those negotiations with the South? Thank you.
Thank you, Paula. In terms of your first question around working in Northern Ireland, yes, you're quite correct that the regulations and the policy around professional regulation is devolved to Northern Ireland, so there potentially are some routes that we can look at. Currently, I have to say that hasn't been part of the programme at the moment. I think it's obviously something we will take away and consider further. At the moment, the healthcare professions predominantly are nationally regulated. The only two that we have locally are the pharmaceutical, PSNI, and the NISC with the Northern Ireland Social Care Council for social workers. So all of the other healthcare professionals are on a national basis. And it does mean that if we defer or move away from the rest of the UK, it can make it more difficult even for the internal market. So there are considerations that would need to be looked at there, but we will take it away and consider those.
Sorry, just before you go on. Sorry, Patricia. Thank you. Okay. It wasn't so much about the regulation of them or the terms in which they come to work within the United Kingdom, but it's really more around the terms and conditions or remuneration that those healthcare workers could possibly be offered, because we know there are so many shortages and vacancies and pressures in our health service here. So it was more around that side of it.
I'm going to have to take that away and come back to you on the workforce issues, because obviously with the agenda for change, a lot of the contracts and the arrangements are centrally organised. But yes, it is something that we are aware of, that there's almost like an attractiveness to work in the different regions. And we understand that, but I will come back to you on that point.
Ms. Blanchard, you might be interested that we are targeting an interest in the pharmacy workforce, and I'm sure that that will be mirrored across other healthcare professionals as part of the health and social care workforce strategy as that is implemented. And last week we launched a massive campaign to promote Northern Ireland as a place to study pharmacy and also to come and work, and with a deliberate attempt to draw back some of our pharmacists like me who studied in England to come back. So now I've managed to get that plug in for us. So it is something we recognise needs to be done. Attention needs to be given to promoting Northern Ireland as a good place to come and work and build your career. And there's a lot of other factors involved there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And just as a wee follow-up to that question of Paula's, is there a growing kind of concern around the ability of the common travel area to deal with issues longer term in terms of workers north-south in particular? Is that likely to become an issue, Patricia?
In terms of the professional qualifications, obviously within the common travel area, it's in everyone's interest within the common travel area that arrangements do come to mutual benefit. We are working with DHSC and with Ireland on the sort of mutual recognition of qualifications issue. Obviously, regulators also need to work very closely together, which they do already. And we also have in place the North-South arrangements in healthcare cooperation, and it's very clear from both UK and Ireland that those are important and they are not EU-based and that they should continue under the Belfast Agreement. So those issues need to continue and develop and grow from now in the absence of the EU considerations.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to go back to the phone. I'm going to go first of all to our Deputy Chair, Pam Cameron, and I'll then go to Colin, and then I'll come back into members in the room. So Pam, do you have a question there for us, please?
Yes, can you hear me, Chair?
Yes, I can. Clear. Pam, thank you.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. And thank the panel for their attendance committee today. And apologies, I've missed probably quite a bit of the presentation. I just want to ask the panel, in terms of what proportion of food or feed entering Northern Ireland from Great Britain is usually subject to controls related to the FSA or its labs in Northern Ireland? And by how much will this increase from the 1st of January 21?
Chair, we'll have to come back to Ms. Cameron on that. We know that you get direct briefing from Food Standards Agency, so I don't have that detail with me in the briefing today. We can come back on that. Thank you.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay, Pam? Yeah, I'll go on then.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'll go then to Colin McGrath on the phone. Colin, could you go ahead with your question there, please?
Yeah, sorry, thanks very much, Chair. And likewise, I might have missed a bit of the presentation and questions there, so apologies if I'm repeating something. I just wanted to pick up on the bit that was mentioned about the North-South reciprocal health arrangements, and then maybe more broader, if there was any update at all about the European Health Insurance Card going forward, because I think people are getting a bit confused that things will happen north-south, but the card won't be in Europe, but maybe people not realise that there's not going to be a card. And I was just wondering if the presenters would be able to give any clarity about that European Health Insurance Card on what the general rules will be.
On the north-south reciprocal healthcare, obviously the UK and Ireland are in negotiations and it's at a fairly advanced stage to make sure that arrangements continue within the CTA. And yes, you're quite correct, that won't continue within Europe. Anyone that falls under the withdrawal agreement will still be able to maintain their rights. So any frontier workers, any Europeans that live here or any UK citizens that live in Europe will be able to maintain their current reciprocal healthcare rights, and they will be able to have and use an EHIC. For everyone else, the EHIC is still part of the negotiations with Europe currently, and the outworkings of that have not been confirmed yet. So I can't give any updates. Currently, the advice is that anyone travelling over the end of the year will still be able to use their EHIC as part of the withdrawal agreement until the end of their visit. So if they're a student, for example, away, they will still be able to use their EHIC if they have been in Europe since before the end of December, even if they've come home for a holiday. Any new people, you won't be able to have to use the EHIC currently until the outcome of the negotiations. And obviously, everyone travelling really should have travel insurance as well.
Okay, so just to clarify that then, so if you're living in Europe at the moment, or if you're a student that's studying, regardless of you live there or study, if you come home and then go back to Europe again, your European card is good. But if you're a new person that's going on holidays or travelling abroad after the 1st of January, at this stage, there is no provision in place unless something comes from the negotiations.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Colin. So I'm coming back then into the room. I'm going first to Aoláidh.
Thank you. Thanks, Cathy and Patricia. Cathy, in your remarks earlier, I just wanted to pick up on some of those. So when you were talking about then that there could be possible disruption at the English Channel, which could arise, and then obviously the contingency plans that you've been working on are now ready and that those are starting to be used. My question is, have you already identified shortages within medicines, or have you made forecasts for shortages if that disruption does arise at the English Channel? That's my first question. And then secondly, just around the data sharing issues. So there's obviously, you had mentioned that there's discussions that are ongoing. I'm just conscious that this has been an issue with the COVID pandemic as well, that we're hearing, getting some of the same feedback, that data sharing on the island, north and south, has been a problem. And I'm just wondering if you could go into a wee bit more detail on what the problem in this context, what the problem actually is, and if the delay in sorting these data issues out, could this delay put patients at risk in any way? And then maybe just finally, Cathy, you had mentioned that you are still waiting on a number of critical decisions being made. And just in your opinion, in the here and now, what would be your most prominent concern or the most prominent decision that you are waiting to be made? Thank you.
Thank you. I can take a couple of those questions if you like. I'll take question one and three, and then I'll hand over to Brendan to advise on the data question. That's okay. So you asked, first of all, have we got any shortages identified at the moment? And I chair a shortage response group here in Northern Ireland that I mentioned earlier. It's our strategic cell, or these different words for things. But anyway, it's a group of people that meet now on a weekly basis that are responsible for representation from across all of our different supply areas. And I can report that today, this week, we have no supply issues across any of those. Now, that's not to say there aren't shortages that arise. There's always interruption in supply chains, but there's none as a result of EU at this moment in time. And there's none that we are concerned about, or they're having to take additional action at the moment. Now, what would happen if we had to, and we do take action? So nothing to do with EU, but you know, the supply chains are global and things can happen at any point in a medicine supply chain. There's some high profile examples like EpiPen and things where, you know, major interventions are taken if needed. And what we've got is we've got a very, very extensive national surveillance now of the whole medicine supply chain. And that means that we can predict, you know, if we see potential issues coming up, and it allows more time to put in place plans. And how that goes out into our health and social care services, we send out advice then from the department and supply disruption alerts, and that gives detailed advice about, for prescribers, if they have to make a decision to change a product from one product to another or something like that, but that at all times to maintain the treatment to the patient. So without risk.
Could I just come back in just on that wee point, Cathy? So it was actually an email that the chair of the committee had got this morning or late last night, and it was from a constituent who was saying that her specialist had told her that prescription, the medication that she's prescribed, that there is it would no longer be available as a result of Brexit. And maybe it's just a wee point around communication. I know you were saying that you know, there's the supply disruption alerts are sent out to you know, the different health and social care agencies, or you know, whatever method they're sent out. But it's maybe just you know, to prevent that from happening. So if it is down to a global supply chain, just that it's clear, you know, so there isn't confusion out there with the public.
Well, I would be very interested in that example, if it can be shared with me, and I'll follow it up.
Yeah.
And also, I should also advise the committee that if a decision is made formally to withdraw a drug from the any part of the UK market, 6 months' notice has to be given by the company. So that means that they have to advise the DHSC, and that's and under our medicines legislation UK wide, so to prevent shocks. But that I will look into, but I'm not aware of that.
Okay, thank you. Going now to Gerry.
Sorry,
go ahead.
The data issue and the critical decisions that user which would be the most prominent, and then just the north south data.
I mean, the most significant issue for me in terms of supplies now is clarity about the Northern Ireland ports and getting the flow in from Northern Ireland. We've done a huge amount of work in terms of we've never held more medical supplies at any point in history probably than we have now in the UK and in Northern Ireland. We do have additional stock here as well in our system. So now I just want that flow to continue unimpeded, and that's my current focus on supplies. But Patricia, have you
on the workforce side and the reciprocal healthcare? I mean, an agreement with Europe on continuation of social security would actually solve and settle an awful lot of minds. Obviously, the CTA agreement is important to make sure that arrangement is in place. Obviously, you know, we don't have decisions on those yet. They're not critical because people still will be able to get healthcare. It makes things a lot easier and simpler, and it's a continuation of what we have now. In terms of the recognition of professional qualifications, it would be wonderful, to be quite frank, if the UK could come to an agreement with Europe. The mutterings that we have heard to date haven't been good, but if the UK can come to an arrangement, that obviously would solve an awful lot of issues around that area as well.
Okay, so just before I go to Gerry, I want to check back with Paula. Paula, was there an element of the second part of your question that you wanted to, that you didn't feel had been fully addressed? Can you just check that with you, Paula?
Not a short one.
Paula, can you hear me there? Okay, I'll come back to Paula after.
Sorry, earlier I had asked and it was going to be addressed by the other participant about data sharing.
Sorry. Okay, thank you for that.
It was one of my questions as well.
Okay, so go ahead, Branton. I'll bring you in there.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Ms. Flynn, for the question. There is actually no data sharing issues that have been reported through the department. And I sit and work for the Chief Digital Information Officer and sit alongside the data protection officer. But processes have been put in place in parallel with the preparation of paperwork. And the paperwork that is the information governance paperwork can be quite detailed. So you may be hearing that the paperwork hasn't been completed or there's delays in completing that, but there's been no disruption to data flows that we're aware of.
Okay. Just as a follow-up to that, there have been no disruptions, but are there things that you're anticipating may create difficulties in the future, and how are those being addressed, Brenton?
No, as part of the original preparations for the full implementation of GDPR, the HSC organisations undertook studies on their data flows and reviewed all their MOUs and contracts, and this is carried over into the EU exit scenario, and we're very confident that we have the appropriate mitigations in place that will allow data to flow regardless in a legal manner.
And are there concerns around the divergence issue in relation to the data in the future? Should Britain diverge from the EU? There's an adequacy decision obviously in place there at the minute, but if there was future divergence, would that impact, and how can that be addressed?
Chair, that's quite hypothetical at this moment, but it would be it's actually the EU would have the issue about transferring data to the UK. The UK has always stated that they will transfer information into the EU because they recognise that they are adequate. So it would be our colleagues across the border who would be pushing to ensure that data could freely flow for cross-border services such as cancer, kidney dialysis, and even Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue, where there are shared services along border regions.
So am I to take it from that that there's some assurance in terms of, say, in terms of this island, north-south, in that unilaterally the British government saying they would allow that to flow, but what about south-north in
the difficulty?
Yeah, what about south-north, Breton?
Well, if that's where the EU may have a problem, yeah. And there consequently the Republic of Ireland may have a problem, but it's hypothetical at the minute because the situation hasn't arisen, and the UK government, who lead on the adequacy decisions and discussions, keep assuring us that they're confident that that will be achieved. It's in everybody's interest to make sure it works.
Yes, and what I'm acutely aware of is that actually, rather than being the EU's problem, it could be our population's problem and the health services problem, and that we could be caught in the middle between these larger discussions and unforeseen consequences as things move on. Okay, I'm going to check back with Paula then in relation to her additional question. Paula, or not additional, but the question that she had asked. Paula, can you clarify that for us there, or repeat your question, please?
Yes, thank you, Chair. It was to ask about the Cross-Border Healthcare Directive. I had said in paragraph 28 of our PAC that it had said that the Department of Health is considering the policy around the application of the principles post the end of the transition period, and I was saying that we're 6 weeks off the end of the year, and when will a decision or information around that be forthcoming? Thank you.
We're hoping to get the information quite shortly to the Minister. We've had to look at some international elements of the agreement because it is with the World Trade Organization. It's around the provision of care, sort of paying for care within a country, whether we did an agreement with Ireland or whether we did an agreement with Europe. So there's some considerations around it that are still having to bottom out. Just to tell you what the issues are. We do have provision, though, that anyone that applies before the end of the year will still be able to continue and have their treatment. It also does not stop a person travelling to have private health care in another jurisdiction. What it does is that they won't be able to be reimbursed for their treatment. But in terms of that, we should have some guidance and some advice shortly on that.
Thank you.
It is concerning, but I have myself diverted so many people who have only been able to get their treatment as a result of that scheme. We're 42 days away and we're hearing should and may and words like that, and that is really honestly causing anxiety out there in the community. This is definitely having a massive impact, and again it's one of these things where we knew this was going to happen, you know, so it is extremely concerning that we're still in these last minute kind of trying to catch up, and as I said earlier, trying to deal with the COVID pandemic at the same time. Okay, I'm going to go across there to Jerry.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for the presentation. Just a quick comment and a question. I suppose that the points-based system is a situation where we need healthcare workers from outside Ireland and the UK. To have a points-based system seems pretty regressive, reactionary, and racist as well. So just a comment on that. On sort of state aid rules in pharmacy, I know there's been a conversation maybe last month about sort of the British government's plans for changing and intervening in the economy around the state aid rules after Exit. Has there been any discussion or research or thought around the benefits of intervening around pharmacy and big pharma? I've seen Medicine Sans Frontiers calling for more transparency around sort of the vaccine and how it's how the trials are conducted around patent rules and issues like that. I don't claim to be an expert in any of that, but I know there's a concern, obviously, for people to get the vaccine as quickly as possible, as safely as possible, but without the possibility of sort of big pharma making huge profits off that. So is there any work or any issues around possibilities around that? Would be helpful. Thanks.
Mr. Carroll, I think it's more of a national question, more on a UK scale. Than specifically in Northern Ireland. What I can tell you is that there will be, our medicines and our medicines regulator, the MHRA, a large part of their work moving forward is going to be promoting life sciences and promoting engagement with the pharmaceutical industry and promoting the UK as a good place to do business. So there will be, and from my point of view, we'll be encouraging that Northern Ireland is well represented in those. So it's more, that would be more our focus, as opposed to the state aid questions probably are more, UK government decisions than something we would seek to influence here directly.
No, I appreciate that, and appreciate there's obviously urgent questions that people have asked, but I think it obviously, people want a vaccine quite readily, as quick as possible, but if there's questions around having a pharmaceutical sector that's not solely for profit, I think that would benefit people here as well as people in the UK. Just finally, on the consent mechanism, Cathy, can you answer any questions about that?
Explain a wee bit more. What do you
just
mean
the excuse me, the vote that's going to come 4 years after the transition period. I don't know if it's your area, but I'm basically looking clarification to see if that is subject to the petition of concern, if we can get some clarity on that, if it's known.
I'd need to take that away. I don't think that is strictly our area, to be honest, but it could. I'm happy for that to be taken away.
Okay,
and,
thanks.
And we can pass it on to whoever. It might not even be our department, I don't think, Mr. Carroll, to be fair.
Okay, Cathy, I wanted to ask you a question on the vaccine, the potential vaccines that are being worked on, and indeed I think it is, we all would agree that would be something that is a source of hope, that there is a vaccine that will have an impact on the COVID-19 situation. It would appear that the South are getting 1.1% of EU supplies of vaccine, which is 20 million doses, and I'm just wondering, potentially, if we were struggling to get supply of dose, and we have seen that in relation to flu, and we know we're operating in a global market, is there potential for us to tap into that procurement route? And also, secondary to that, is it the case, and are you planning for the rollout of the vaccine to be coordinated on an all-island basis, in the sense that we are a single epidemiological unit, and therefore, I take it, to provide population immunity, you would need to have it coordinated north and south?
Chair, it isn't my policy area. I'm sorry, the detail of the vaccine rollout. I can advise that we don't foresee any issues in relation to EU exit in terms of handling the vaccines and getting the vaccines into Northern Ireland. My understanding is that we're dealing with the Northern Ireland population, which is our responsibility. But that other colleagues in the department would be best placed to provide the detail on that, which we're happy to relay.
But in terms of your own substantial experience as Chief Pharmaceutical Officer, do you agree that a vaccine programme needs to be coherent across the island to provide protection for our populations, both sides?
We don't work on an all-island basis at this moment in time. I'm sure the committee are aware. We work in terms of the Northern Ireland and Southern Ireland, but aligned in terms of principles and in terms of objectives for public health. And I can't see that being any different this time around, Chair.
Okay, and I appreciate that, but I would just suggest that should be a piece of work that's ongoing to make sure we are aligned. Given that it makes sense, obviously, I'm just flagging that I think it would be hopefully an urgent piece of work, in the sense that hopefully the vaccine will be soon available and we will want to have that coordinated rollout in place.
Sorry, Jonathan. Just as you've mentioned, vaccine, and I appreciate probably this may stray onto another portfolio, but in relation to EU exit, etc., do you envisage any problems of, say, for example, vaccine secured by the UK government to then be placed out on a devolved settlement perspective in terms of allocations? Do you anticipate any difficulties in that vaccine being rolled out from GB to Northern Ireland in the event that a vaccine is coming, and in particular if there's any difficulties surrounding the Northern Ireland protocol?
Again, I mean, I'm aware that this is not, I'm not here to speak in detail about this.
Of course.
The Northern, it's based on a population level share of what the UK government are entitled, are able to draw down from global supplies, and Northern Ireland will receive their share of the vaccine, and that will be allocated in, and we don't anticipate any issues in relation to EU.
Okay.
That could arise because the vaccine could come over, after the end of the transition period.
Yeah, no, because I suppose that's probably after hearing your concerns that you've put forward in relation to other medicine supply, etc., with where we are. I suppose probably the year extension has removed some of those immediate pressures, but then the concern is rightly out there. Well, then
the vaccines will be coming directly into Northern Ireland.
Yeah, directly to Northern Ireland. Okay, thanks.
And is there, Cathy, again from your chief pharmaceutical angle, is there consideration being given to how we would deploy a vaccine here? Because obviously there are different ways to use a vaccine. Are we developing a dedicated plan to how we use a vaccine in the context of the North that suits the particular unique situation we have with healthcare? And
that work is going on right now, Chair. Okay. At the department and within the HSC, so all of that plan is underway.
Okay, members, I think that is. Sorry, I have an indication there from Pat Sheehan on the phone. So Pat, go ahead there with your question, please.
Thanks, Chair. I just wanted to ask Brenton a question about the data sharing, and I wonder if he is aware of data not being shared by the South in relation to travellers coming in, particularly through Dublin Airport and coming north, because there was a problem with that relatively short time ago. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Sheehan. I believe that relates to the travel locator forms, and that isn't strictly healthcare data. I believe it relates to border security as such, but it is information that people would need. So I'm not, it's not within my policy area.
Okay, so despite the headline that there are no problems with data sharing, we have a situation here where this particular data relates to a healthcare issue, but there's a problem in sharing it for other reasons.
Maybe I was unclear. I probably should have stated there's no problems around direct healthcare information being exchanged. Direct care being for those treatments and life-threatening cases.
Okay,
there may be issues outside of our remit.
But there are clearly problems in other areas of data sharing.
Out with the direct responsibilities of the Department of Health, there may be, but that's not... have enough to cover with what we're doing at the minute.
Okay, thanks for that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, members, and thank you to our panel today for your presentation and your answers and your commitment to send on some further information there at a few parts of the session. Thank you for attending, Cathy, and thank your entire team, and good luck in the time ahead. And I do honestly wish you all the best of luck, because this is... Just can I ask one final question, Cathy? What's your key concern at the minute in terms of the EU exit stuff? What issue is top priority for you?
I think the main thing for me out of all of the issues are the healthcare, is the healthcare supplies. And but there is... an enormous amount of work has gone on, and I think that now it's just about you know, providing assurance and drilling down into some particular areas that we still need to focus on. So we're really moving into a very active phase now in terms of attention on this, and also, and you know, and I'm in contact with wholesalers, a pharmaceutical industry, and we have very good levels of relationship there. So you know, that, I mean, I think it's important to provide that assurance to the public that there's a huge amount of work has gone on, but that we're keeping a very active watch on this now in the coming weeks, Chair.
Would you seek additional time similar to the medicines issue if it was required, and do you think it would be granted if the situation was serious enough to warrant it?
I think that the additional 12 months that we have secured, our understanding is that cannot be extended on the medicines issues, that is a definite red line, if you like, in terms of a new deadline. And on other matters, I think there are some critical decisions that we're waiting to, you know, as we've outlined during the briefing today, there are some critical decisions, and you know, and as I say, as a result, it may be a good idea for us to provide a further brief, Chair, and I'll take your advice on that in a few weeks' time.
Yeah.
And we would be very happy to do that.
Yeah, I think that might be actually something that. So, thank you for that. Thank you for staying on due to the technical issues. Thank you for staying on beyond the scheduled time. Appreciate the answers and good luck.
Yeah.
Good luck for the future there. Thank you. Okay, members. I have to say that was actually something I was thinking of in terms of the urgency and the speed with which all these things are happening. It may be the case that we do want to touch base with Cathy and the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer and her team again before, and I'm also conscious there of that discussion around the vaccine. Would it be the case that maybe, given we've been told that's a different team, should we consider looking for a briefing in around the vaccines issue? Members are content with that, and content that we explore an additional Brexit briefing session? Go ahead, John.
Sure. In relation to the Brexit briefing, and I think we'll all agree that the 12-month grace period is potentially a game-changer in relation to the pressures that they were facing, as was outlined by Cathy. But it's what we do with that grace period. Mm-hmm. And I would suggest, in the way in which we did see a joint letter going from both the Deputy First Minister and the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister in relation to food supplies, that potentially the committee consider writing to the executive, the Department of Health, to press them to use the grace period agreed to press the UK government to ramp up its case for mutual recognition between the EU and the UK in this area in the medium to long term, because that's going to be crucial regarding the supply issue. So I think that's something that the committee should give consideration to, given the importance and the strategic importance of medicine supply to Northern Ireland in a post-Brexit scenario.
Members content with that? Any other views, Ailish or Clerk? Sorry.
Can I just check a mutual recognition of, if you would spell out mutual recognition of what?
It would be mutual recognition between the EU and the UK in the area of the falsified medicines, so medicine supply, in the medium to long term. And I'm happy to provide that in probably an email to you, Clerk, and to the rest of the committee if it was.
Well, I'm just not clear how that's different to what the 12 months that's in place now, Jonathan.
So my understanding is the 12 months has bought time for industry to readjust, to provide a potential scenario as to what the end game may look like. But in that 12-month period, there should be a case placed to the UK government to ask for mutual recognition of medical products, which would settle, from briefings that I have had with medicine suppliers, would solve a lot of the issues, because there would be very little difference in EU-sourced medical products compared to that of GB.
Could I suggest you send the warden through to get a look at, because I'm just not clear about where...
I can send that through to the other committees, but I think it would be important for the committee to do.
Okay, members, any other issues then before we move off this topic? No? Okay, thank you. So we'll move on then to, we're going from item 6 to 11, and we are looking to move now to our consideration of 6 statutory rules regarding coronavirus travel restrictions. Do we have all the officials on the line, Clerk? Yeah. Okay, so I refer members there to tab 6 to tab 11 of your pack. The Examiner of Statutory Rules has reported on item 6, SR 2020/228, Amendment 16 to the Travel Restrictions Regulations and advised that it was laid in breach of the 21-day rule, but the examiner is content that the department has provided a satisfactory reason for that breach. The examiner will report tomorrow on Amendments 17, 18 and 19 and 20 and SR 2020/247 in relation to Denmark specifically, but has advised that while all were laid in breach of the 21-day rule, again, the examiner has accepted the reason given for the breach in the context of the department's urgent response to the pandemic. I can advise members that officials from the Department of Health are here to brief the committee on the regulations and to take questions. We will then consider each SR in turn. So I would now like to welcome by video link this morning to our committee meeting, Ms. Gillian Hines from the Health Protection Branch, and also Mr. Brian Dooley, Head of Health Improvement and Policy Branch. So I would just like to go ahead and invite the officials to brief us. I'm not sure if it's Gillian or Brian, but if you could indicate which of you are briefing, please.
Good morning, Chair. I will do an introduction first of all, and then we can follow up with questions.
Thank you. Go ahead, Gillian.
Good morning, members, and thank you for the opportunity to brief the committee on the changes to the travel regulations. I will outline briefly the changes made by each of the sets of regulations in question. Amendment 16, which was made at 4 a.m. on the 25th of October, this added all of Greece back onto the list of exempted countries from which travellers are not required to self-isolate on the return to Northern Ireland, along with the Canary Islands, Denmark and the Maldives. The amendment also removed Liechtenstein from the exempt countries list. Amendment 17, which was made on the 31st of October and the 1st of November, and this amendment amended the passenger information in Schedule 1 to the principal regulations, which passengers arriving in Northern Ireland must provide. This included adding a requirement for seat numbers, coach numbers and vessel names. It amended the exemption for visiting forces and offshore workers in Schedule 2 to the principal regulations, which specifies individuals who are exempt from the requirement to provide information or to self-isolate. Cyprus and Lithuania were also removed from the exempt countries list. And finally, a range of sporting events that had now passed were removed from the sporting exemption list, with a number of forthcoming elite events added, and these were checked with Department for Communities. Amendment 18 came into force on the 6th of November and 7th of November. And if this was based on the risk assessment, it removed Denmark, Germany and Sweden from the exempt countries list. Denmark was removed when the regulations were made on Friday, the 6th of November. Germany and Sweden were made at 4 a.m. on the 7th of November, which was in line with the rhythm that we've agreed with England, Scotland and Wales regarding the announcement and coming into force time. Amendment 19, which came into force also at 4 a.m. on Saturday, the 7th of November. This was brought in very quickly in order to respond to the risk associated with travel from Denmark, given the evidence of transfer of a COVID-19 variant from mink to humans. Given the risk and the emerging situation, this amendment removed all exemptions from the need to self-isolate for those who have arrived in Northern Ireland from Denmark or who have arrived in Northern Ireland from elsewhere and during the 14 days preceding their arrival in Northern Ireland have been or transited through Denmark. It also required those living at the same address to self-isolate also. Amendment 20 was made on Monday the 9th of November, and this removed any exemption to provide information and complete the passenger locator form for those arriving from Denmark. And finally, the Health Protection Coronavirus Travel from Denmark regulations were made on Tuesday the 10th of November. These prohibit the arrival of flights and ships direct from Denmark unless they are commercially operated and have no passengers or are operated by the government. It also creates an offence for an operator to allow such a flight to land or a ship to moor unless it is necessary to secure the safety of the vessel or the health and safety of any person aboard it. Given the scope of Amendments 1920 and the Coronavirus Travel from Denmark regulations, these will be kept under review. That is a short summary of the changes made in these regulations, and we are happy to address specific queries the committee might have.
Okay, thank you, Gillian. First one from me is in relation to the self-isolation and the monitoring of the self and support indeed for those who need to self-isolate. Can you give us any update in relation to how that's being monitored? What kind of figures are coming back? Have there been any requests or assessments made that people need dedicated support, and has that been provided?
I can kind of pass it on to Brian. Brian's wanted to address these questions.
Thank you, Gillian. Yes, Brian, go ahead.
Hello, Chair. I can't give you an update in terms of numbers. I would have to get an update from Border Force who are monitoring this. So I'm not currently aware of requests for such assistance, but I can provide a written update.
Okay. Okay, and you know that does. I have to say, and I want to reflect this very clearly to officials. It concerns me, given this is a public health emergency, that it's being treated as a border force. That people genuinely might arrive in here, and I have come across some cases where travellers have arrived here, have tested positive, and then have been asked to leave their hotel. And some of those issues have been addressed on a case-by-case basis, but there's very little sense of an overarching system to support travellers in order to protect the population and in order to allow them to self-isolate in the way they would need to. Given we're so many months on now, from a health perspective, is there not a concern here that the support is inadequate?
In the short time that I've been in post, Chair, it hasn't been brought to my attention in the department that there have been those issues, but there may well have been in the past. So all I can say is that we'll liaise with colleagues in the PHA and the Border Force, and we'll try and give you a proper update in relation to those concerns.
Okay, thank you. And then in relation to the Denmark and the issue around the mink, and there's been a lot of changes made there back and forward, and a lot of additional regulations brought in around that. But given, I say in a report yesterday, given that there are now, I think, strains of that mink variant detected throughout other European countries, what assessment is being made of how that issue it needs to be perhaps widened? And are there concerns that we have a very clear focus on Denmark, but we may be missing what's happening in those countries clearly surrounding Denmark?
Okay, Chair. Well, I can assure you that the PHE and the JBC and the CMOs and the Chief Scientific Officers are aware of the European-wide situation. So we have had a specific focus on Denmark in the last couple of weeks, but we're also monitoring other countries in Europe. For example, those countries where there would be mink farms. But we're also aware of the situation that you described where there was a variant that had come from Spain. And our understanding is that had actually gone to other countries in Europe and will have come to the UK and Ireland. The particular mutant variant that you've referred to that came from Spain, our information to date shows that there's no evidence that this form of the virus spreads more easily or causes more severe disease than the other forms of the virus. And in the view of the relatively minor changes in its genetic structure, it is unlikely to have any significance in terms of vaccine development, diagnostic effects, or potential for immunity. So that other mutant referenced from Spain, we don't have concerns at this stage, but we are monitoring it and looking at the epidemiological evidence as we collect it.
Okay, and there is some reassurance there in terms of as far as that goes, that it appears there are no. However, I think it does flag up the concern that any variation or any jump would indicate that we need a very robust system across the island of Ireland in terms of travel to respond to future mutations, which may create greater difficulty in terms of transmissibility. So again, I want to flag that I think, and I think that it's essential that we have a health focus in relation to travel. I think it's too much of an immigration focus in that sense, or border force, and that those border force officials, I have no issue that they're trying to do their job to the best, they don't have maybe an understanding of the health imperatives. One final one from me then before I go to members. There's been a lot of changes around sporting competitions, and I'm just a wee bit baffled as to what impact that has on us, why there are so many variations around sports, what's creating that kind of churn within sports and the need for continual regulations. I think we've seen on occasions maybe Welsh cricket team, or there's been various things that don't appear to have great significance here. So can you give us some more information on that?
Yes, Chair, I can completely understand your viewpoint. We tend to replicate the regulations as they occur in the other four, amongst the four nations. And so a lot of the exemptions in relation to elite sporting events probably don't relate to Northern Ireland. And that's why we would tend to check with the EFC locally to see what is relevant and what isn't. But because these regulations come into effect so quickly, we often end up copying across the entire list.
Yeah, but...
And as the events then complete, we then take them off. So that probably accounts for the amount of changes that you're seeing.
But again, it raises that concern that's been ongoing, and I think there has been an understanding in the initial months about how quickly everything had to be done. But I would expect and hope to see a growing sophistication within our systems and within our responses to take account of our unique sporting environment, unique challenges in that we have a land border. All of these types of issues are unique to here. And while I don't necessarily say we shouldn't adopt things that make sense, but are there other things that we are missing out as a result of over-reliance on central information coming from Britain?
Hopefully not. We do liaise very closely with our colleagues across the water. Probably almost every second day we're in communication with them. But we also communicate internally within Northern Ireland with other departments and with Border Force and Police and so forth. So we do our best to try and keep the communication channels open to try and make sure that the information that's provided to the public in Northern Ireland is relevant to them.
And how are you communicating North-South in relation to those issues?
Well, similarly, there would be communication between the North and the South. Probably not, obviously not as frequently as with UK colleagues.
You see, I honestly would suggest that it should be every bit as frequent, if not more frequently, Brian, in the sense that there is so much interaction, and that again concerns me that we're not seeing that development. I know the memorandum of understanding is in place and was welcomed and has been welcomed by us, but we would have expected to see that being built upon over time so that we get better and better at responding. I would like you to commit today that there will be, and I think we can be provided with the minutes of the meetings to see what type of issues are being discussed in relation to that North, South and East, West?
Yes, Chair.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to go now to members then. I'm going first of all on the phone. I'm going to go to our Deputy Chair, Pam Cameron. Pam, could you go ahead, please?
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, panel, for your time today. I suppose just to kick off briefly on the Denmark issue, and I'm seeing a news article coming through from RTE reporting a potential cull of mink in the Republic. Obviously, we're aware we don't have any mink farms here in Northern Ireland, but that is a real concern that you know, the potential impact on any vaccines coming forward in the near future. So I'd be very concerned that there is sufficient engagement and that there's sufficient enforcement around the travel regulations, and especially in terms of self-isolation. So I wanted to ask how effective the enforcement has been in respect of self-isolation requirements, and I wanted to ask if you have any information around how many fines have been issued and if the 4E approach used by the PSNI to cover forms of non-compliance and operation, you know, whether that's sufficient enough, and is there a tougher stance taken in terms of failure to actually self-isolate in particular?
Okay, thank you for that question. Gillian can correct me, but I think there have been 48 fixed penalty notices issued for breaches of self-isolation in the community in Northern Ireland. And that's been enforced by the police.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, Pam.
Are you confident that that's enough, given, you know, given the, especially in light of the Denmark scenario and that potential threat of that new strain?
Okay.
Yes, I
take that point. In relation to Denmark, we've been very strict in terms of what we've done. No passengers are able to come to Northern Ireland or the UK from Denmark. So we've been stricter here than anywhere else in Europe. And we have had cooperation from colleagues down south in relation to contacting people that have come from Denmark via Dublin to Northern Ireland. So they've been quite proactive in terms of helping us by contacting those passengers that have been through Denmark in the 14 days preceding when the exemption came into, when the regulation came into effect. So we have been doing quite a lot around Denmark, and we've got very good information, we think, from the JBC around the situation in Denmark. And as you pointed out, there is a cull of almost 17 million mink, I understand, and that's progressing. And the Deputy Chief Medical Officer in England has expressed confidence in the measures that are being taken in Denmark. So in relation to Denmark, we feel that they've been very competently reacting to the situation, which is quite serious. So I would have some confidence around the situation in relation to the mutant variant from Denmark.
Okay, but in relation to the mink farms currently on the island of Ireland, within the south, and I believe there may be a mink farm in Donegal, you know, what's the scenario there? Are if the south is talking about culling or is actively seeking culling of mink in Republic of Ireland, does that mean that variant strain is present in the Republic of Ireland? And have do you have sufficient information to be confident that there has been no exposure in Northern Ireland with travel from Dublin to Donegal passing through Northern Ireland?
Right. Because this has all happened so quickly in the last couple of weeks, I would have to get back to you with an update from colleagues in Dublin and in other Republic. I understand that there are three farms in the Republic of Ireland that do have mink farming. And I understand that there was a plan to actually phase that out within the next 3 years. So they were in the process, I think, of minimising that exposure. But in terms of what the current up-to-date situation is, I would have to get back to you with a proper written update. I don't know that the answer to that question at the minute. But we've certainly seen no evidence that there is any such mutant variant in Ireland.
Okay, thank you. And Jonathan? And after Jonathan, I'll be going to Paula on the phone.
Yeah, I'll just be brief. Is there any data on the number of arriving passengers from Denmark that if these rules have affected? Any specific numbers?
We did receive some information, but I would rather give you a proper update than try and recall exactly what the numbers were. They were very small, less than 20 from memory.
Less than 20?
I believe so, but I can check that.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going back then across to the video conferencing to Paula Bradshaw. Go ahead, Paula, please.
Good morning, panel. Thank you very much for being here this morning. I would just like to ask what advice will be coming forward in relation to students returning from GB for Christmas, whether you're engaging with the universities, UK government, or how is that being coordinated in terms of the advice around potentially self-isolating coming from areas where there are hot spots? Thank you.
Because we deal with the international travel regulations, that really wouldn't be my policy area, but I can certainly get you an update, a proper update in relation to that.
Oh, no, I would really appreciate that quite quickly. I was trying to put it on the record with the Department of Health for 6 months before the two students arrived back in the Holy Lands and look at the unholy mess that have resulted from that. So I'd appreciate if we could get a swift response in relation to that. Thank you.
Thank you. And then panel, a number of the regulations come into force on, say, for example, I'll just look at regulation there 2020/232. Sorry, 243, and it says that it came into force on the 7th of November, but it was made on the 7th of November. But however, section 39(2) of the Interpretations Act 1954 implies it would only come into force the next day. Is that correct, and does that present a problem?
Chair, is the one you're referring to the Amendment 19?
SR 2020/243, Gillian, I don't have the amendment number in front of me there.
19.
But it's across, it's 19. Alan's indicating it's 19, and it cuts across a number of them, but taking 19 as an example.
Yeah, that's one that was made very urgently on the Friday night because of the Denmark issue, and it was made around about 1 o'clock on Saturday morning, and Emma had it coming into force at 4 a.m. So it was a very urgent amendment.
But what I'm asking is, given that it's urgent, does the fact that the 1954 Act means it only comes in the following day, does that create a problem in these urgent situations?
We can
Brian, go ahead.
I think that's a good point, Chair, and we need to get back to you on that.
Okay, thank you, members. Any other questions in relation to those?
Sure.
Jerry, you were in there. I'll come back to you, Alan. Jerry first. Yep.
Thanks, Chair. Just a question. I mean, obviously, we're talking about mink today, but are there any other animals that this virus could sort of develop and spread in? And I'm just kind of thinking, what is the process? So we get a warning for toxic in Europe for like a weasel or a ferret for toxic. Is there a monitoring process that officials from the department or from DERA would check sort of farms or livestock? How does that process actually work when there's a warning or there's a concern in Europe or elsewhere about the potential spread from animals?
I would have to discuss this with the Chief Scientific Officer to get a proper response. I wouldn't know for certain, so I'd rather not answer, but I can give you a written update.
Yeah, I would appreciate that, because I mean, obviously, I think mink are part of the same family as weasels and ferrets. We don't have many mink, it seems to be, on the island, but there's other animals we do. So I'm just kind of trying to get the process. If we get a warning signal from Europe about another animal, you know, how many staff are working to investigate to make sure that it hasn't spread and or developed in those animals. So that's in broad terms what I'm looking for information on, if I can.
Yes.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. And then Alan.
Yeah, just Chairman, just to get a little bit of clarification, this enactment bill from, I think it was 1954, it suddenly came out of the woodwork. And I mean, we have been, and the Assembly has been passing SRs and SLs for the last couple of months. Nobody has queried us about it not coming into force until the following day. Could I get clarification? Does in fact this Enactment Act of 54 does it trump the dates that are in these SRs that we have been passing? You know, or because they are emergency legislation, and because the date of operation is very specific in it, and because of the circumstances and the urgency with which they're being brought forward and applied, if we can't get it this morning, can we get information back? Does this Enactment Act, in fact, trump the dates that we would wish these things to come into operation?
Yes, that's a very good question. Because of the public health risk at stake, there may be a means by which it is effectively trumped, but we'll get back to you on that.
Thank you.
Okay, and I just want to check very quickly if I see an indication there from Pat. Is that from the previous question, Pat, or do you have another question that you were looking to ask in relation to that? Quick question. You're still on mute there, Pat.
I have another question in relation to data sharing. Just following up from my question to the previous contributors.
Yeah, go ahead, Pat.
Okay. I'm just wondering, I suppose this is a question for Brian. I'm wondering if they're aware of a problem with data sharing, particularly in relation to travellers coming through Dublin Airport and heading on to the north. And if there is a problem, does that relate to anything to do with the border force? Thanks.
There is an issue, and it's being discussed, and there's been correspondence between the Minister and the CEMO, so it is being addressed, and it's in relation to the the amount of information that we would like to be able to properly enforce the regulations.
So what are those problems then, Brian?
It's really around the information that you need to enforce a regulation. For example, if you've got the address of somebody so that you know where they're self-isolating. So that in order to issue a fixed penalty notice, you would need an address, for example.
I understand that. I'm wondering, what is the reason for the blockage? Why is the data not being shared?
I'm afraid I don't know. I think one of the reasons was in relation to doubt around legality in terms of whether they were able to share the information. And that's why there's been the correspondence, because we've tried from different angles to try and resolve it. And we're sort of slowly getting there, but we obviously want to do it as quickly as possible.
Okay.
And where is Border Force in the middle of all of this? What role are they playing?
Well, they are involved, obviously. But I guess there's only so much they can do in terms of the fact that passengers are entering into Dublin. So it's how we liaise with our colleagues down south.
Well, okay, well, I appreciate it. If you could get back to us with some more information around that. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. And final question then on this section to Orlea.
Yeah, Chair, thanks. Sure. It's just a comment on Pat's question and the detail that Brian covered there. I think it might be worthwhile the committee writing off to the department or the minister once again on this issue. I know that he did refer to it in correspondence that he sent the members, I think it was 2 weeks ago, but we also, I did raise it, was it 3 weeks ago, when we had the minister and the chief medical officer in front of the committee, and the issues with the data sharing north and south, we've been talking about them for months now. So each time we've received an update, including from the minister himself, I know that he was saying that we keep hearing that they're working towards having the issues resolved, you know, that there might be legal issues, that, you know, it was being raised at the North-South Ministerial Council meeting. But I just think it would do no harm trying to get a further update in writing as to, you know, where the standstill is now and how and when it's going to be rectified.
Yep. Okay, thank you. Members would, listen, first of all, what I will do is I'll thank the officials for attending. We can discuss that proposal. I think that's more of a proposal than a question, really, isn't it?
Sorry, yes. Sorry.
Okay, so I will thank both Gillian and Brian for attending our meeting, for doing your presentation and answering questions insofar as you could. And we will welcome receipt of the information that you've committed to passing on there, both of you. So thank you very much and good luck for the future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, so are you proposing, Orlea, that we write to the Minister requesting all correspondence is sent in relation to this North-South issue and around the data? Is that what your proposal is?
Well, really, it was just because we already have had correspondence regarding it, but it just seems that the issue isn't moving any further on. And, you know, we're talking months now, not weeks. So just to, you know, I know in the letter that the Minister had sent us the other week, it wasn't specifically just around the data sharing issue. He had actually addressed a number of different issues. But I think on this particular subject that we need to do just maybe a focus letter on providing the committee with the details around where is the blockage coming from, what is the issue, and how and when is it going to be rectified.
Okay, well, what I would suggest maybe is that we write to the Minister. I'm conscious that he is back with us on the 3rd of December, but in order to inform that, that we write to the Minister, ask him to send all correspondence in full in relation to those discussions around travel restrictions and the contact tracing information to capture the passenger health locator information. Are members content with that? Yeah. Members content, thank you. Okay, members, I'm going to now go back to going through each of those individually, as we normally do. I will remind you of the topic of each of them, and then we'll consider them in turn. So, going first to SR 2020/228, I refer members to tab 6 of the pack. These regulations add the Canary Islands, Denmark, the Greek island of Mykonos and the Maldives to the list of countries and territories exempt from the 14-day self-isolation requirement. The regulations also remove Liechtenstein from that list. Those regulations came into force on the 25th of October. Have members any further issues they wish to raise in connection with that statutory rule? No, thank you. Members then, can I ask you to agree formally that the Committee for Health has considered SR2020/228, the Health Protection Coronavirus International Travel Amendment No. 16 Regulations 2020 and has no objection to the rule? Are members agreed? Great, thank you, members. Number 7 then, SR2020/234. I refer you members to tab 7 of your pack. So I advise members that this SR amends the passenger information which passengers arriving into the north must provide, amends the entries relevant to visiting forces and offshore workers, which specifies individuals who are exempt from the requirements to provide information or self-isolate, removes Cyprus and Lithuania from the list of countries and territories exempt from the 14-day self-isolation requirements, amends the list of specified competitions relevant to the exemption from the requirement to self-isolate for elite sports persons, provides exemptions from self-isolation requirements for passengers who have passed through exempted areas in the 14 days prior to arrival in the north, and provides that those who have passed through non-exempt areas must self-isolate for 14 days on arrival. Those regulations came into force, into operation on the 1st of November. Have members any further issues they wish to raise? No, thank you. So can I then ask members to agree formally that the Committee for Health has considered SR2020/234, the Health Protection Coronavirus International Travel Amendment No. 17 Regulations, NI 2020, and has no objection to the rule? Are we agreed? Agreed. Thank you, members. Moving on to SR2020/241. I refer members to papers at tab 8 of the pack. These regulations remove Denmark, Germany and Sweden from the list of countries and territories exempt from the requirement to self-isolate for 14 days after arrival here in the north. The requirement to self-isolate in respect of travellers from Denmark came into operation when the regulations were made on the 6th of November and the next day in relation to travellers from Germany and Sweden. Have members any further issues they wish to raise in connection with that statutory rule? Thank you, members. So can I therefore ask members to agree formally that the Committee for Health has considered SR2020/241, the Health Protection Coronavirus International Travel Amendment No. 18, Regulations 2020, and has no objection to the rule. Are we agreed? Agreed. Thank you, members. Moving on to SR2020/243. I refer members to papers at tab 9 of the pack. These regulations remove exemptions from the requirement to self-isolate for people who have arrived in the north from Denmark or who have arrived into here from elsewhere, and during the 14 days preceding their arrival to the north have been or transited through Denmark. The regulations also require people residing at the same address as Denmark arrivals to self-isolate. Those regulations came into operation on the 7th of November. Have members any further issues they wish to raise? No, thank you. So therefore, can I ask members to agree that the Committee for Health has considered SR2020/243, the Health Protection Coronavirus International Travel Amendment No. 19, Regulations 2020, and has no objection to the rule? Are we agreed? Great, thank you, members. Item 10 is SR2020/244. This SR provides that current exemptions in respect of providing information applying to, for example, diplomats and those employed in transport do not apply if that person has arrived into the north from Denmark or has within the previous 14 days departed from or transited through Denmark. The regulations came into operation on the 9th of November. Have members any further issues they wish to raise in connection with that statutory rule? No, thank you. So therefore, can I ask members to agree formally that the Committee for Health has considered SR 2020/244, the Health Protection Coronavirus International Travel Amendment Number 20 Regulations NA 2020, and has no objection to the rule. Are we agreed? Thank you, members. We're agreed. And finally, then, in relation to this section, SR 2020/247, the Health Protection Coronavirus Travel from Denmark Regulations NA 2020. These regulations prohibit the arrival into the north of vessels and aircraft travelling directly from Denmark. Certain vessels and aircraft which depart from Denmark. The regulations came into operation on the 10th of November. Have members any further issues to wish to raise in connection with this statutory rule? No, thank you. And therefore, can I ask members to agree formally that the Committee for Health has considered SR 2020/247, the Health Protection Coronavirus Travel from Denmark Regulations NA 2020, and has no objection to the rule. Are we agreed?
Okay,
members, we're going to move on to considering legislative consent motion. I'm just going to take a very quick, short break there. Could members try to be back for 12 o'clock, please, to resume that session? Thank you.
Chamber.
Okay, members, thank you. So we are now resuming with item 12, which is the legislative consent motion, amendment to the Medicines and Medical Devices Bill. I refer members there to tab 12 of the pack and table papers. Can I remind members that the committee's consideration of this LCM was interrupted during last week's meeting due to technical difficulties? Members agreed that we would forward questions to the committee office, which were then sent to the department for a response. The department's response is at tab 12.7 of your table papers there, members. The responses have also been added to the draft report from the committee. I can advise members that the Committee for Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs have forwarded its comments to the LCM, and those are included at tab 12.1 of your pack. So, members, the next stage in relation to this LCM is for us to formally consider if we are content to support the Department in seeking the Assembly's endorsement of the legislative consent motion. The motion has been tabled for debate in the Assembly on the 30th of November. So, before I put the question, are there any issues that members wish to raise in relation to this LCM?
Jonathan? Thanks, Chair, and I suppose because I didn't get to put on record outline my opinion on the bill at last week's committee meeting, but no objections in principle, particularly around the need to improve and enhance information sharing relating to medicines and medical devices, and also ensure that each devolved region of the United Kingdom is fairly and consistently treated. However, concern is still present. I don't think there's anybody. Is there anybody online to ask questions to?
No, we had the questions we submitted had been answered by the...
I suppose probably I'm still unclear as to the extent that the Northern Ireland Protocol would create difficulty in such information sharing that already has been outlined probably in a lot of the COVID-19 regulations by other members, the problem with data sharing. But again, in relation to this particular bill, I'm unsure as to how the Northern Ireland Protocol would create difficulty in such information sharing should, for instance, the safety standards underpinning medical devices used in Northern Ireland begin to differ in some sense to GB, or there is inevitable divergence in the future. So I suppose it's just to put that concern down. I see some of the department responses, but again, it still doesn't really answer some of the main thrust of my argument as to the concerns that I would have.
And members can raise those concerns, I suppose, as part of the debate as well. So any other issues, members, that members wish to note or... No, okay, well then I'm going to go ahead and put the question to you members that the committee is content to support the department in seeking the Assembly's endorsement of the legislative consent motion, that this Assembly endorses the principle of the extensions to NA of the provisions within the Medicines and Medical Devices Bill dealing with human medicines, veterinary medicines and information systems as amended at committee stage in the House of Lords. So are members agreed? Yep, members are agreed. So then, can I advise members that it's normal practice for committees to produce a short report on their consideration of the LCM? A draft report is included there at tab 12.6 of your table papers. And do members have any issues that they wish to flag up in relation to that draft report at 12.6? No, okay. Okay. So are members therefore content with the draft report? Yeah. And our members agree that the Minister's correspondence, the legislative consent memorandum, and the correspondence from the Committee for Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs be added to the appendices of that report? Yeah, members are content with that. Okay. Okay. Okay, moving on, members, then. I just want to check with the clerk, do we think we can move to the children? No. So we'll go to correspondence, members, and then we'll have our discussion on the children's regulations following that. So moving on now to correspondence. And can I refer members to tab 13 of your pack and your table papers, and also to the correspondence memo at tab 13.1. There's a few items that I would like to draw members' attention to. Item 13.2 is a reply from the Minister regarding urgent and emergency care at the Down Hospital. Do members have any comments in relation to that? Nothing indicated there. Would members be content to note that, pending the scheduled briefing from the Department on the 10th of December on the review of urgent and emergency care?
Agreed.
Yep. Yes, members are agreed. Thank you, members. Item 13.3 then is a reply from the Minister regarding access to cannabis-based medicines. Do members have any comments in relation to that issue? Are members content to note the correspondence?
Yep.
Yeah. Thank you, members. Moving on to item 13.9. This is a commencement order in relation to the Mental Capacity Act. This postpones the commencement date for the offence of unlawful detention from the 2nd of December 2020 to the 31st of May 2021. Do members have any comments in relation to that?
Sure.
No? Okay. So would members therefore be content to note that pending our further and future scrutiny of the implementation of that legislation? Yeah. Thank you, members. Item 13.10 then is from an individual expressing concerns around the post-primary transfer tests. Do members have any comments in relation to that correspondence? Okay, I am advised that the Committee for Education is dealing with correspondence on this subject. Could I propose that we forward this piece of correspondence to that committee, noting the mental health issues raised?
Great.
Members content? Paula?
Thank you, Chair. No, I just want to put on record my concern as well. I do think it's an education issue, but it's also very much a public health issue, especially at the far side of Christmas, because we might find that because some parts of society will open up over Christmas and people will come together more, there's a high chance that there could be children going into the new year requiring to self-isolate, who could potentially miss the transfer test itself. So I would appreciate if we could be kept updated with what the Department of Education has to say about this as well. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Paula. So moving on then to item 13.16, which is from the Chest, Heart and Stroke, regarding funding provision for services provided by the voluntary and community sector. Do members have any comments in relation to that? And would members be content that we potentially seek a further update on funding for the sector? Would we look for an update on that issue, given the concerns that sector have expressed in a number of forums? Yeah, thank you, members. Item 13.17 then is an invitation from the Law Centre to the Chair and one other committee member to a round table event to discuss changes to the special benefit rules for people with a terminal illness. I am happy to participate and looking forward to participating in, but can I ask any other interested members to contact the clerk to express an interest? Okay, thank you.
We have data of that, Chair. Do you know what data that is, do we? Emails, is it?
I don't have it in front of me here, Jerry. It will be, I think, in the memo, which is at 13.17.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Yep. Okay, members, so moving on to 13.21, which is an update from the Department of Health on the issues affecting dentistry during the pandemic. So any comments then, members? Obviously, we've been quite centrally involved in relation to this issue. Do any comment from members there in relation to that? We do have a kind of penciled in briefing from the CDO, the Chief Dental Officer, on the 3rd of December. In light of the other additional issues we've raised today with Brexit and with vaccines and that, Would members be content, or are there any counterproposals? Would members be content maybe we reschedule that again for the other side of Christmas? And at which time I think we'll be able to have a sort of a better understanding of how dentistry issues are faring out. But would members be content with that proposal? To defer that briefing? Thank you. Okay. Okay, item 13.22 is from the Department of Health, advising the Committee of UKSA, the Control of Mercury Amendment, EU Exit Regulations 2020, to ensure that current EU regulations will be operable as retained EU law after the end of the transition period and to reflect the Ireland NI Protocol. The statutory instrument falls to the Committee for Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs for scrutiny, but the Department of Health has an interest as the regulations include provisions around the use of mercury in dental amalgam. The Department advises that it is not concerned about any immediate implications. Have members any comments in relation to that? No. Thank you. Then are members therefore content to note the SA? Yes, members are content. So are members content? With the other actions as suggested in the correspondence memo of 13.1 of your pack? And there just was one issue there that I wanted. 13.6 is relating to figures on the number of enforcement measures. I think it would be important that that's shared regularly with us. Would members be content that we ask the department to ensure that these figures are shared regularly with the Health Committee on an ongoing monthly basis? Just so we can keep an eye on that and watch out for. And also, I would be interested as to who issued the penalty notices and the community resolution notices. I'm not sure what the difference are in those and how they're being implemented. But I wonder, could we ask for some clarity in relation to the two types of notice, one being the penalty notice and the other community resolution? Are members content with that? Yeah, thank you. Okay. So members otherwise content to note the actions as suggested in the correspondence memo at 13.1? Yep. Members are content. Thank you. We then, members, are hopefully moving on to our consideration of the children's SRs. So it's SR 2020/235, the Children's Social Care Coronavirus Temporary Modification of Children's Social Care Amendment Regulations 2020. And members will remember that earlier in the year, the Department of Health made regulations to make temporary modifications to allow health and social care trusts and independent providers of children's social care services some flexibility in the provision of essential services to look after children in need and care leavers during the pandemic. It was anticipated at that time that the requirement for the modifications would be temporary and that they would expire on the 7th of November 2020. However, the Department now advises that it intends to extend the operational period of the regulations for a further 6 months until the 7th of May 2021. The Committee have sought the views of stakeholders on the proposed extension of the temporary modifications, and we have received submissions from Barnardo's, Nicky, the Human Rights Commission, BASWA, VOIPIC, the Fostering Network, NI Guardian Ad Litem Agency, the Children's Law Centre and the NSPCC. The Clerk's Memo is at tab 14.1 and submissions can be found at tab 14 of the pack and table papers. On behalf of the Committee, I would like to thank the stakeholders for their submissions, which will assist us in our consideration of the SR before us, and indeed to also thank the Clerk and her staff for that substantial outreach to those very, very important sectors. The Examiner of Statutory Rules will report tomorrow on this SR and the Principal SR, which was 2020/78. But has advised that while the regulations were laid in breach of the 21-day rule, she is content that the Department has provided a satisfactory explanation for that breach in the context of the urgent response to the pandemic. I can advise members that officials are here today to brief the Committee on the amending regulations that will extend the operation of the temporary modifications. So I'd like to now welcome by video link Ms. Eilish McDaniel, Director of Childcare and Family Policy at the Department of Health, and Ms. Deirdre Mahon, who is Director of Women, Children and Executive Director of Social Work in Western Health and Social Care Trust. So you're very welcome, Eilish and Deirdre, and I would now like you to go ahead and brief the committee, please, and we are very keen to receive your briefing this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair, and good afternoon to you and to members. Just first of all, thanks for the opportunity to brief the committee on the Children's Social Care Coronavirus Temporary Modification of Children's Social Care Amendment regulations. The regulations were made on the 30th of October and came into operation on the 5th of November. Members have been provided with the SL1 notification outlining their legislative effect. And in short, the statutory rule amends the expiry date of the principal regulations from the 7th of November 2020 to the 7th of May 2021. If content, I'll very briefly summarise the purpose of the principal regulations and the basis on which the Department considered it necessary to amend the expiry date. Deirdre will then describe to the committee some of the challenges currently faced by Health and Social Care Trusts and drawn from examples in our own trust. The principal regulations provided trusts and other independent providers with the flexibility were needed to maintain essential family and children's services in the face of service challenges caused by the COVID-19 pandemic. Those challenges were mainly due to a combination of staff absence, increased service demand and requirements in accordance with public health advice. In accordance with the department's guidance supporting the regulations, and they're to be used only where absolutely necessary for the shortest possible period, underpinned by continuous risk assessment and the exercise of professional judgment. And the department is satisfied that to date this guidance has been adhered to. The department also made a commitment to committee members and key stakeholders that the use of the regulations would be closely monitored and this data used to inform whether they should remain in place. Monitoring has been underway since June, and the data for the first 4 months showed a steady decline in reliance on the modified regulations and a gradual return to business as usual. Many of the modifications were not being used at all, and in the majority of areas there was a decrease in reliance on them by trusts and independent providers. Rebuild plans for children's services indicated that children's services would return fully to business as usual by the end of September. Our intention from the outset had been to revoke the regulations at the earliest possible stage. On the 2nd of September, when we shared the July monitoring report with the committee, we considered that it would be possible to revoke by mid-September if the situation continued to improve. However, over the following 3 weeks in September, the picture changed rapidly. Localised restrictions were imposed for parts of Northern Ireland from the 10th of September, with Northern Ireland-wide restrictions introduced on the 22nd of September as infection rates rose steeply. Further restrictions were then imposed in the Derry City and Strabane Council area on the 5th of October. And in light of these changes, the department concluded that it would be no longer appropriate to revoke the regulations early. But at that stage, the intention was still to allow them to expire on the 7th of November. By mid-October, all trusts had moved away from rebuild planning, I mean within children's services, and back into surge planning. The department had begun to receive information from trust directors that staff absences were increasing sharply due to a positive COVID-19 test or a requirement to self-isolate. So for example, in the Western Trust, by the 9th of October, 70% of its Northern Sector Gateway team in Derry had tested positive and were unable to attend work. An additional factor is the predominantly female workforce in children's services, meaning that above average rates of maternity leave compared, there are above average rates of maternity leave compared to other sectors. And the advice to pregnant women working on the front line is that they must work from home after 28 weeks. And this has had a significant impact within children's services, compounded by the fact that there are limitations on the work that social workers can do from home. As expected, the October monitoring report, which I shared with the committee earlier this week, shows a renewed increase in reliance on the flexibility provided by the regulations in most areas. And the current challenges, we expect to see further evidence of this reliance in the monitoring data for November. Among the children's services most severely affected by the second wave of the pandemic has been residential care, where staff have been unable to adjust their working practices other than using PPE in response to the pandemic. For example, they can't work from home if required to self-isolate. From the 12th of October, the department started to receive early alerts telling us about COVID-19 outbreaks in our children's homes. And in fact, as recently as Monday, the 9th of November, I was advised of a COVID-19 outbreak at the Regional Secure Care Centre at Lakewood in Bangor, leaving it in a critical position where 42 staff are unavailable and for work. 21 have tested positive and 21 have had to self-isolate due to close contact. The most recent information I received was that a further 5 staff were awaiting test results and 2 were shielding. A number of children and young people have also tested positive. New admissions are prevented for the foreseeable future. And in the meantime, trusts are having to manage locally those young people who might otherwise be admitted to secure care. Higher rate of infection during the second wave has seriously obstructed redeployment options that were available during the first wave. Across children's services, teams and trusts at the 31st of October, there were 242 staff absent and unavailable for work for COVID-19 related reasons. For example, staff testing positive or becoming symptomatic or having to self-isolate. In the Western Trust, for example, 112 staff were unavailable for work, 53 in the Southern Trust and 48 in the Southeastern Trust, and that was before the Lakewood outbreak depleted staffing resources even further. At the same time as trusts were responding to the staffing challenges, I've described demand for children's services is extremely high. For example, in the past week, there have been 91 child protection referrals, and that's a 133% increase in weekly referrals since the first week of April, when weekly data collection began. And since April, there's also been a 34% increase in the number of referrals to children's social services, and there are now 109 more children in care. There are growing concerns about some foster carers and their ability to cope with restrictions and young people having to be off school or sent home to self-isolate. There have been a number of foster and adoption placement breakdowns. In addition, the demand for residential care for children under 12 years of age has increased, requiring statements of purpose to be adjusted. Some pressures are not directly COVID related. So for example, current provision for the accommodation and care of separated and unaccompanied asylum seeking children is now at capacity. And there's the additional pressure of unaccompanied children having to self-isolate for 14 days when they arrive in Northern Ireland. In light of the pressures I've described, the department received representation from trust directors of children's services that they needed the regulations to stay in place to allow them to maintain essential children's services. At the earliest stage of the second wave, the general view of directors was that it felt very different from the first wave.
Sorry to interrupt you, Eilish. Could you just slow it? It's a little bit hard to follow some of the detail at times. The lines are slightly patchy, but could you just slow it down a little bit, just please? Just hard to pick up some of the detail if you just... Thank you. Sorry, Eilish. Go ahead.
I'm conscious of your time. I will slow. At the earliest stage of the second wave, the general view of directors was that it felt very different from the... they've also described unpredictability, with some services becoming unstable very quickly, as demonstrated by the events in the Secure Care Centre, in other children's homes and gateway services in the Western Trust. We consider that to revoke the regulations at this stage in the pandemic would be to risk placing trusts and other providers in an invidious position where, for example, a COVID-19 outbreak might leave a social work team with insufficient staff to continue services in accordance with normal regulatory requirements or timeframes. Yet not to do so would mean acting outside the law. This would not be in the interest of either our trust or the children and young people in their care. While the modifications are enforced, the department retains the ability to apply and keep under review guidance to trusts on best practice, where resources and or restrictions don't allow them to comply with...
Eilish, sorry, we've just lost you there. Eilish, we lost you there for a second. You're saying resources to comply, and we lost you at that point.
Apologies for it. I've just gone on to say advised, and I think the committee is aware of that. So the Children's Commissioner, for example, has been advised along with a number of other organisations. I met with the Children's Commissioner on the 11th of November, and she recognised the pressures on children's services are significantly greater than during the first wave, and appreciated that there's a need for the modifications to remain in operation. She emphasised the importance of monitoring for the purpose of ensuring that the regulations are only being used when absolutely essential. And in light of the Commissioner's concerns, the Department will publish its monitoring report every 2 months and not quarterly, as previously indicated. The Commissioner has rightly asked what supports are being put in place for staff, given the pressures that they're currently under. And Deirdre will provide some information on what is in place within trusts to support staff. The Commissioner has particular concerns about staff working in children's homes, given both the intensity and importance of the role that they undertake. We've invested an additional £3.3 million to support contingency arrangements in children's homes and supported accommodation by providing temporary staff to help address staffing deficits arising from COVID-19 related absences. Recruitment of additional social worker and social care staff is progressing via the workforce appeal, with 128 social workers or social care staff at pre-appointment or appointment stage, and a further 685 at an earlier stage in the process. In addition, the department has worked with trusted employers to expedite the recruitment of recent social work graduates, with the result that 194 graduates have been employed since April, and that's a significant increase on previous years. The department has increased capacity by commissioning an additional 15 social workers via the Open University, many of whom are currently working in social care. Workers are also being recruited to assist in children's services, including children's homes, providing extra support and broadening the skills mix. So, for example, in the South Eastern Trust, 26 youth workers are currently being recruited. I've had cited the response from the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission, and the Commission acknowledges that the regulations have not been excessively relied on to date, and that their usage has been regularly monitored. It recognises the gravity of the current situation and the renewed pressure on trust during the second wave. I fully accept the points it raises that the use and any flexibility must be proportionate, no more than is required to deal with the emergency, and only to apply for as long as is necessary to address the pandemic. As before, we give a commitment to the committee that the regulations will be revoked at the earliest opportunity, and hopefully that will be well in advance of May 2021. And at this point, I would just like to ask Deirdre to describe in some more detail for the committee some of the challenges that trusts are currently facing in practice.
Okay, and just before I go to Deirdre there, Eilish, could you, we lost some small parts of that through the way. Could you provide us with a copy of your speaking note, maybe, which would fill in the information that you've conveyed there to members for us?
Absolutely will, Chair. I'll do that after the meeting. Yeah.
And could I also remind all participants on video conferencing to keep your phone on mute, because if there's other phones active, it can cut in that way that happened with Eilish there. So please put your phone on mute unless you're speaking, and I'll go across then to Deirdre. Thank you, Deirdre.
Okay, thanks, Chair, and good afternoon, everyone. So I'll start just with give a bit of a background to the issues that the Children's Commissioner raised in relation to psychological support for staff, particularly staff in residential care. So every trusted psychological helpline for staff, which is actually used regularly, it's manned by trust psychologists, and there's a framework in relation to that. Also, staff and children's home have direct access to psychologists managing with them and during their team meetings. We have offered quite a lot of practical support for staff in residential care, testing hubs, accommodation, showering facilities. In the West, we've actually bought 3 sets of clothing for staff to wear to close to work. They didn't want to wear scrubs for obvious reasons. It's a children's home is a home, and the children didn't really want to see staff in scrubs, so we bought tracksuits and stuff like that. There are drop-in clinics for staff. There's monthly reflective forums chaired by a psychologist and taking place in all the children's homes. In the Western Trust, we have a framework for staff wellbeing and psychological support. And on quite a few occasions, the psychologists have gone into the children's homes and had reflective sessions with the staff, talking about their anxieties, any issues they have. And I have to say, the staff in the residential homes have been fantastic. They haven't really demonstrated any particular issues as this pandemic has gone. Probably in the very early stages, in the first month, there was a lot of anxiety. But as time goes on, and a lot of the we now have the outbreak in Lakewood, but a lot of the young people have, you know, joined in the behaviours around PPE. They're helping cleaning with their masks on. And they know when to use them, when not to use them. The staff know when to use them. And the young people have become part of the solution in our children's homes. So it hasn't been a major issue. But having said that, the psychological support is there for staff when and if they need them. So I can answer more questions about that, Chair, if you want. The other thing, maybe then, just to say, to put the modifications in some degree of context, as Ailish said, staff have only used these regulations when enough they need them. And that's really, really important. I mean, no one wants to dilute the service that we have unless it's absolutely necessary. And that's borne out, I think, as Ailisha says, that we used them less and less during the last surge. And as we got somewhat back to some degree of normal over the summer, we were using them practically not at all. And then, unfortunately, September, particularly with ourselves in Derry and Strabane, we needed to use them more and more. And then the staff then was fearful that the regulations was going to be stood down, and that they felt that actually this was the time they needed them even more. And it was causing quite a lot of stress to staff, Chair, because the regulations have timeframes in them. And for a member of staff to have a review or do a statutory visit within a 4-week period when we were down on staff and they were working from home and they were having to slow down the work that they had to do because they were sometimes going out to someone's house, coming back in, having to get showered and changed and going out to somebody else's house. So they weren't going from house to house to house as they previously had done. So it slowed everything down for them. And to have to do visits within 4 weeks, which is what the original regulations are, was causing them undue stress, and sometimes having to do visits at 9 and 10 at night just to get it within the time frame. So having the modifications of the regulations allows them a degree of flexibility if they need it. And that's really important to say, if they need them. Because otherwise they'd be breaking the law, and that just causes them so much stress. The other things that's very challenging in relation to trying to live within the regulations is that, you know, you have foster carers, for instance, quite a number of them were shielding. A lot of our foster carers are in the middle aged, and they were shielding or older and didn't really want children or social workers coming in and out of the house all the time. So children that were going to visit family, for instance, their own birth family, and then all that contact and then coming back into their home. So social workers had to find creative ways, because obviously families have a right to see their children and the children have a right to see their families. But a lot of that was being done virtual. Some of them, well, they were going to contact room, but the room had to be cleaned down between visits, which slows everything down as well. So there's a whole lot of variety of different things that happen very differently. And as Ailish also said, you know, in the Gateway team in the Western Trust, and for those members who aren't aware, the Gateway is the front door of social services. It takes all the referrals. And at one point I had 18 staff down, significant number of them that were positive. The others were self-isolating. Well, the Gateway service can't go unstaffed, because that's the front door. That's where all the referrals have to come in. So we had to redeploy staff from other service areas in there to make sure that there was always staff there. But that meant that the other service areas weren't doing what it was that they were supposed to do. So we're all the time juggling, moving around, trying to provide the absolute best service for children and families, trying not to use the regulations, the modified regulations if we don't have to, but it's a great safety net there for staff if we need to use them. I have a whole lot of other examples, Chair, but I'm conscious of your time. So I think that's enough for now, and then we can I can answer questions if that's helpful to people.
Okay, thank you, Deirdre and Eilish, both for the presentations. A couple from myself first, and then I'll go to members. You'd mentioned there, Deirdre, and it is very, very welcome and important in relation to the psychological support for staff. But I'm just wondering what additional psychological support for families and for, in particular, the very, very vulnerable cohort of children that we're speaking about here, what additional psychological support has been provided to those people?
Yeah, we have a helpline for families. We've been doing a lot of support for families. I mean, a lot of the families haven't been as anxious in relation to the contact issue. The issue for families, Chair, as you could imagine, is poverty. It's the impact of unemployment. We have been offering a lot of support to families in that particular way, but also psychologically as well. If families are anxious or worried, you know, there were families, for instance, not so much interestingly in this part of the surge, but in the earlier surge, who didn't want any social workers in their house at all. So we were doing a lot of conversations through telephone calls, digital meetings. Sort of the challenges for a lot of families in poverty is that they didn't have access to the digital, they didn't have laptops, they didn't have access to a lot of the technology. So a lot of the families obviously had phones, but they didn't have access to the technology. So the social workers have been working very hard with families, trying to make sure that we can loan laptops, we can loan iPads, and also helping them getting the technology on their phones if they need that to take part in meetings. But social workers are there every day supporting families the best they can. But, you know, with everyone, it's a very challenging times for all families. For children, we've done a lot of work. Our looked after psychologically support has been doing that for families. We also have child psychotherapies who've been working with children direct, making sure that they're, you know, because for children, it's not so much COVID for children, it's a lockdown for children. So we have really good contracts with some of our community voluntary agencies. They have been working very hard, taking children out, working with children, particularly Extern, for instance, taking children out of the home, making sure that they're being supported, that they're able to do some fun things, trying to do that within social distancing. It's not easy. And again, this time with the this surge, at least children have school, which the first time was actually very challenging not having that. Having it this time makes a huge difference to the support that's being offered to children.
Okay, thank you, Deirdre. And actually, I should have there, and I will declare my own interest in relation to my previous work as a social worker. So I do have that sort of background and understand. But I wanted to clarify before my question, Eilish, did you say, or what figure did you give for the increase in referrals over the past while in relation to referrals?
Okay, so there's been 143% increase in the number of child protection referrals since earlier pandemic.
133, did you say, Eilish?
133% increase. So in terms of numbers, the weekly average on the 6th of April, which was when we started to collect data weekly, the average was 39. Referrals per week, and by the 16th of November, it had 91.
We lost you there after.
That's the weekly average.
Deirdre, Ailis, your phone line's very intermittent there. We lost you just after. I'm not sure if there's anything you can do in relation to, you don't have a headset or anything like that we could try?
Maybe she turned off
her. I actually don't have a headset, and this is the first time the connection does seem to be quite bad.
Maybe try turning off your video. Ailish, maybe try.
We have all of these figures recorded so that we can give them to you in thing. But 133% increase in child protection referrals, 34% increase in the number of referrals the 6th of April. 109 more children in care than there were on the 6th of April. 90 more children on the child protection register, and that's compared to December of last year, 2019. But I can give you all of these figures in writing, Chair, along with the opening statement.
Yeah, if you actually send us maybe your speaking note there, that will have, and those figures, that'll be appreciated. Would you try there turning off your video, maybe, Ailish? It might help us. We might have better audio if you suspend or switch off. So, are you still hearing me there now, Ailish, just to check?
I can still hear you, Chair, yes, absolutely.
Yeah, and it might be slightly better. We'll see as we go. So, listen, I asked for those figures just to give to set some of the context around this. And I also am aware that from evidence at a committee, I think yesterday, I'm not sure if it was here or potentially in Westminster, that we have here 2,400 approximately children on the at-risk register and 24,000 children who are known to social services. So that's to give some context of the vulnerability and the extent of people, young people that we are talking about here. I was also struck, Deirdre, during your presentation when you said that as a result of COVID, some families didn't want social workers coming to the house. Unfortunately, we also know that some of these families don't want social workers coming to the houses for other reasons. So yeah. What steps have been taken to ensure that where you're doing an assessment with a young person over a laptop, for example, where that's available and that's a separate problem, but where you're doing that assessment, how are you assuring yourself that there's not someone out of sight of that laptop listening to the questions, listening to the answers, making eye contact with that vulnerable young person? How is that being managed?
Yeah. Chair, that's a really good point. It's really important to point out that initial assessments of families that we don't already know are not done virtually. We are going out to the house to do those. All child protection visits are being done. Staff are wearing their PPE and they're going out to the house. Also, all children in need referrals, of which there is considerable worries, are also all being done. So they're not being done virtual. And you're right, you know, we were very, very mindful that if someone doesn't want you out to the house, what's that about? So all those have been risk assessed. Staff are experienced to know, you know, why someone doesn't want you out to the house, etc., etc. People are still going out to the house if necessary. Some visits have actually taken place in the gardens. They've taken the child out, they've talked to the child on their own, as opposed to just through a laptop. The sort of ones that are done more through laptops, Chair, would be children in foster care who've been there for some time, and they're very settled, but that they're entitled to a statutory visit every month. A social worker has to visit them every month. So those are the type of ones after a risk assessment that would be done virtually. But what we have tried to do is mix them up a bit. So 1 month might be virtual and the following month will be a face-to-face contact. So it's really making them up to make sure that there's no child who's not being seen regularly face-to-face by a social worker, even if that's, as I say, in the garden or outside the home. So we're very, very clued into those issues, Chair. You're absolutely right to put that out.
Thank you. And then going on to the broader issue around the whole suite of emergency legislation, and I just want to reflect that this committee is particularly concerned about this cohort of people and the impact that emergency or legislation of a nature in particular that's impacting on the frequency or the quality of those so important visits. And I am also conscious from a lot of the responses that we've got, and again to thank all those, but say the Human Rights Commission and I think the Younger Persons Commissioner have flagged up the issue of reliance on emergency legislation. And I think it's very, very important that we guard against the sort of creeping normalisation. We should be struggling and fighting to get back to the maximum protections for any vulnerable group of people. But given that the monitoring reports show different levels of reliance on the various types of flexibility, why have you chosen to roll over the entire suite of provisions? And is that both necessary and a proportionate approach? That may be for Eilish.
Chair, again, it's something that was done very quickly, and we had intended to take the regulations away. And I've referred to the unpredictability that directors have actually referred to the department, and I think on the basis of that it was done quickly, that we weren't absolutely certain what way the second wave was going to work out, that we considered it important to keep everything in place rather than to start to unpick the regulations and keep some and drop other regulations. Again, I'm just going to make the point that the intention is to take the regulations away as quickly as we can possibly do it, and genuinely hoping that can be in advance of May next year.
Can I speak to that? Is that okay?
Yes, go ahead.
I mean, just to back up what Elise said, Chair, the last surge didn't have the huge of impact on service delivery and children's services as we had predicted. This one feels very, very different, and I don't think that we have even reached the peak yet. We still have the whole of the winter to go. So we don't actually know yet how much we're going to need to use the modified regulations or not. But it's really important just for me to emphasise again, and what Eilish is saying, if we don't need to use them, we won't use them. And that's really important to say.
Okay, and in relation to, and everyone knew, and it was well anticipated that there would be a second surge at some point. That was taken for granted, and I take your point that there are elements of this surge which feel differently, and I'm going to come back to that in a different section. However, what I would like to know now is what other steps were considered to avoid this legislation having to be brought back in. So was there consideration given to increase testing of those key staff to ensure they could go out and protect that key at-risk cohort? What other steps were considered rather than simply reintroducing these regulations?
I suppose what we tried to do, Chair, too, was to introduce more capacity into the system too. You know, so I've described some of the funding that has been provided to children's services, additional money going into our children's homes, but we've also put nearly an extra £5 million into family intervention services too, and that's all for the purpose of trying to increase capacity within services. In terms of testing, that hasn't been done, but it's certainly something that we can consider. Deirdre, I don't know whether you want to say anything on the testing point at all?
Well, I think, you know, we are hearing that staff in health and social care trusts are going to be, towards the end of the year, I think, hopefully going to be tested more regularly. So that will be really, really welcome, and that'll be less reliance completely on the regulations. But it's important that it's not just staff that have the issues in relation to the visits or the reviews. It's also families and other professionals. A lot of our work in children's services, Chair, as you will know, is multidisciplinary and interagency. So it's all those agencies really working together. And it's, you know, foster carers. I mean, to give an example, we had to take three children into care recently, and both parents were positive, and we couldn't get a foster parent to take the children, understandably so, because the children were also deemed to be positive. Now, that was really, really challenging for staff. After a lot of negotiation and a lot of skilled work, we managed to actually get a placement for the children, but it was very, very challenging. And it's also to point out that in the previous surge, not a single social worker was positive. We had no COVID really in our community services within the trust, and this time it is completely different. Every day it changes. Every day there's more staff positive, there's more staff self-isolating. So it's very, very different from the last time. We had all these systems in place the last time. We had ghost rotas in residential care. We had staff redeployed. We were ready for staff to be depleted, and it didn't actually happen, which was wonderful, but it has happened significantly this time, and it really did take us a bit by surprise, because we didn't expect, certainly in Derry and Strabane when it first kicked off, we weren't ready for that, to be honest, Chair. We thought we knew that there was going to be a winter surge, but we thought the winter surge would be the end of October, November, but it actually started in September. And it started in the community, which hadn't happened the last time, so it did feel very, very different.
Okay, and I do think that is a relevant area of concern, that planning for that second surge wasn't up to scratch, either in terms of potentially quantity and also timing. So I think there are lessons to be learnt there. And my suggestion in relation to the staff, the testing of staff, does apply to all those multidisciplinary professions that you talk about. I'm talking about everyone here who's employed in protecting and caring for these vulnerable children. I believe there should be as much effort as can be put in place to protect the current capacity, as well as building additional capacity, which I welcome also. So that's the issue. I'm going back then to your point that both of you raised in relation to this feels very differently. There's a lot more impact on staff this time around. Both of those things would indicate to me that there's much more likelihood of these regulations being used more regularly. Therefore, I'm wondering, and we have also heard that the data is being collected weekly, I'm wondering, therefore, what the rationale is for proposing that monitoring reports would move to quarterly. And I recognise you've said you have considered, in relation to the Younger Persons Commissioner, you have considered moving that to 2 monthly. But what is the rationale for moving that at all, in terms of the concern now that we're going to see more, potentially more usage?
Okay, Chair, so yes, the weekly data collection will continue, but that's not related to the monitoring data that we also collect, connected to the regulations that's collected on a monthly basis. So I just want to correct that. Okay. Again, that decision was made at a point in time where we were very uncertain about how this was going to transpire. You can't provide flexibility to the system and then, I think, impose something else upon it in terms of the collection of data and monitoring, maybe at a time when that is going to be very difficult to do. I mean, it's done between the trust, the board and the department, you know, so there's resource used in all three of those places, and we were just very conscious of the implications and the imposition upon those three parts of the system at potentially a very difficult time. Very happy, Chair, to reconsider that if that is a particular blockage and sticking point, particularly for the committee.
Can I come in there?
Yeah, go ahead, Deirdre.
Just to say, Chair, as Eilish was said, there are two different data sets. The monthly data sets are appropriate monthly because a lot of the visits and the statutory functions take place on a monthly basis. So actually, it wouldn't make a lot of sense to do them any less. You know, wouldn't make sense to do it on a weekly basis, because it is every month that you notice it. But as Eilish said, we don't have an actual digital solution for this. So staff are manually having to put in into a SharePoint site whether or not a statutory visit took place or didn't take place, whether a review took place. And that's a whole lot of extra work for them to do. Whenever we started doing the monitoring, I mean, there was a lot of resistance from staff initially to saying, you know, you're giving me some flexibility, but now you're making me do this other stuff as well. And we had to re-emphasize to them that this was the law, you know, if we're going to modify the regulations, we need to monitor this very closely, et cetera, et cetera. So to do anything more than once a month I think we would meet an awful lot of resistance from staff.
I wasn't suggesting more than once a month. I'm focusing on the less than once a month is what I'm focused on. All I was saying was that some of the data is being collected anyway. Why can't it be compiled and forwarded? It is also crucial in this context, while there is flexibility, and flexibility is being provided here, accountability is also hugely important, and one of the only ways we can track the impact this is having, given the concerns you have raised that this is likely to be used much more widely this time, I think it would be, and I think the committee would be more reassured if we could keep an eye on that on a monthly basis. So can you commit to that, Eilish?
Absolutely, Chair. We will commit to implementing monthly monitoring and reporting.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to members then. I have Paula and Pam on the phone and then coming into the room. So Paula, please.
Thank you very much and good afternoon, ladies. I have two questions, and well, they're almost statements. The first one is the concern around the mental health of the young people in care and looked after.
Sorry, Paula, just let me interrupt you there for a second. Deirdre, I think it's your line, there's a bit of feedback, like a crackling. I think it's on your line, Deirdre, but it seems worse when you're speaking. Could you ensure that you're on mute, Deirdre, only except for when you're actually talking? So go ahead again, Paula, sorry for the interruption.
Thank you. It's in relation to the long-term impact of these restrictions and the whole COVID pandemic on the young people. We know a lot of the times that the impact can be delayed. So I'm just wondering, you mentioned there, I think, Deirdre, around a lot of the young people seem quite upbeat and they're involved and, you know, almost engaged in the process. And I'm just wondering, is some of that being masked or not really the impact not being properly felt? And the second issue, I have a constituent who, a young lady whose foster arrangements have broken down and she's quickly been replaced, but the whole stress is making her underlying health conditions worse. So, plus, on top of that, she's had to self-isolate during this term already. So I'm not apportioning blame at all, and everybody has worked very quickly to get around her. But I'm very conscious, an A-level student, and I'm very conscious that there needs to be some read across between what yous are seeing in the young people you're working with and the impact from this lockdown in terms of their potential academic achievement come this next set of exams. And the question really is, how are you feeding in what yous are seeing into the Education Authority and its own contingency plans for next year's summer exams? Thank you.
For your first point, Paula, is the young people in residential care, the staff have a very, very good relationship
Deirdre,
with them.
Deirdre, I'm going to check. I think actually there may be a problem with your headset, and I know we've asked some people to use a headset, but I think there's a crackling coming through. It might be can you come off your headset and give it a try, please, to see if that's any better.
Is that better?
Yes, I think it is.
Yes.
Oh. Yeah, go ahead, Deirdre.
Okay, so Paula, your first point is that young people in residential care, I don't think they are, ma'am. The staff know them very, very well and they have very good relationships with them. And it's important to point out these modifications of the regulations. There's only delaying some stuff or allowing an extra time to take place. The young people still all will be seen and they'll all be seen by their social workers. Every young person in care will have a personal education plan. So if they're at that age of 18 or 17 and they're doing A levels, then there should be ongoing pathway plans, education plans with education to make sure that they are working through or working towards what needs to happen for that particular young person. And we've had some fantastic successes with young people in care where schools have been really, really helpful in making sure that they've got the absolute best. We've, a few young people who are doing medicine and master's degrees and are doing really, really well. The other thing to say is that, and Eilish might be able to say more about this, but there is a regional therapeutic network that just started out using some of the transformation, confidence and supply monies. And that's looking at all young people in care, making sure that there is, that we increase the therapeutic support that we offer for those young people who are in care, who, don't forget, have already most of them come from a fairly traumatic background, and they've all suffered some degree of trauma in their life, even if that trauma is lost from their families. So all that healing needs to take place. It can be challenging if that young person's self-isolating, or, you know, is more distant than normal. But like CAM service are all doing virtual conferences and consultation through video link through this, which, you know, suits a lot of young people sometimes, because that's how they like to communicate. But just to assure you that there will be a pathway education plan working towards that and linking with education.
Sorry, thank you. Just as a follow-up, I meant it not even so much in the care homes, but it was even just the looked after young people, and again, maybe even in some ways they haven't even processed the impact of this lockdown and maybe not being able to have visits with their siblings, and it's really just the early intervention around that.
Yeah, and we're very, very mindful of that, and every case is risk assessed. And children tell us all the time that they would rather, that one of the things that they want more than seeing their parents is seeing their siblings. And we've heard that many, many, many times, and we're very, very mindful of that. And I will say, Paula, we've learned that over the years. You know, years ago, if mum didn't turn up for contact, then contact was cancelled. But young people have told us, why did you cancel contact? I needed to see my brother or my sister, and actually they're more important to me. So we have changed our practice significantly in relation to that, Paula. So they are seeing their siblings in so much as it, they're able to do with the foster care shield, and it's working with, to be honest, our biggest anxiety is working with foster carers who are really anxious, particularly if they're elderly or shielding, with children coming out of the house and going back into the house. And that's where a lot of support has to be, say that, you know, how do we manage that? You know, how do we make sure that the child sees their siblings or their parents, and yet their foster parents still feel safe? Because this can put placements, make them very fragile, and we don't want to do that either. So it's managing that whole process. We're very mindful of it.
Thank you.
Can I just make an additional point, just to say that we're working jointly with the Department of Education on a look after children strategy, and I think there's a paper with both the Health Committee and the Education Committee at the minute, setting out what we plan to achieve by way of that strategy. And I think in that context, there's the scope for information to flow to the Department of Health and Department of Education, relating to maybe some of the impacts that there will be for looked after children who may have to sit exams next year. So I just want to assure you that there's a mechanism for that to happen.
Okay, thank you. I'm going then to Pam. Deputy Chair Pam. Go ahead, Pam.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you both very much for your attendance at committee today. I think it's been a very interesting session, and it's really good to hear all that you've had to say today, and certainly I certainly don't underestimate the challenge of the jobs that you have and the very vital work that you're doing. And actually, your evidence backs up certainly my party's concerns around not just COVID in itself, but the impacts of poverty and the impacts of mental health, especially on children, young people, and those with disabilities. So I really do appreciate the very kind of personal nature of the conversation today, because I think that's really helpful for us going forward. And certainly as a party, we completely understand the need to extend the regulations. We don't like them, we understand that, and I take it from you, you don't actually like them either. I don't want to use them, but it's a necessary evil at this point. Continuity of care, obviously, and service to users is really imperative. And I certainly wouldn't like to see that quarterly reporting happening. So hopefully that won't be the case, and it stays more to a norm where possible. But my questions for you, do you expect the current increase in child services referrals to level off or to continue to increase during the second wave? And I'm also very conscious that we could have a third wave, and that might not be too far behind the second wave if we even get out of the second wave. And I wanted to also ask you around your opinion on how critical the reopening of schools has been to positive intervention in situations where children are at risk, and bearing in mind that very large increase of child protection referrals. That is very concerning, but I think even more concerning would be the idea that there's no mechanism or no easy way for those referrals to be made, because it's much better that you know that there are issues that need to be dealt with and looked at, and that children need to be protected. And finally, I wanted to ask if there have been any asks made of the Minister in terms of looking for additional skills or recruitment or resource in any form to deal with this.
Okay, so if I can just come in first of all, and then Deirdre can come in behind me if necessary. Yeah. In response to your question about will the numbers continue to increase, I think it's very difficult to predict, although all of the information before us indicates that there has been an upward trajectory since the start of the pandemic, when there was an initial drop. And that kind of feeds into your second question, which is about the relationship between the numbers going up in schools being opened or closed. I think that initial drop in referrals, I think, was a direct consequence of schools being closed. And we interestingly saw the numbers, certainly relating to referrals from education, we saw those numbers drop again when schools closed during the circuit break. So I think it's really important that there was the significance of having children in school, not only to meet their educational needs, but it also is a protective mechanism too for some children. Deirdre, did you want to come in behind me at all on any of the questions?
Yeah, it's exactly the same. So the last time, as I say, we had a reduction during the first surge of referrals and network, which was very worrying to us, because schools were closed. They're our main source of referrals, those and the police, and we weren't getting the same level of referrals. And, you know, I was always saying, you know, it's lockdown, it's the risk to children. We don't know what's going on behind closed doors. And we didn't have our, what we call, you know, our social guardians in the community, our safety guardians, which is, you know, a lot of the education, for instance, being a main one. So referrals started going up, which it was, you know, it was almost a perfect storm. Referrals started going up when staff started going off. So it was kind of hard to kind of manage that process at the same time. But you're absolutely right. Education, schools being back on, is significant importance from a safeguarding point of view. Someone is seeing that child every day. They're getting fed every day. Schools can pick up if a child is happy or sad or what might be going on at home.
Thank you, dear.
Trying to supplement that.
I'm sorry to cut across you there, and I'm sorry, but I'm just getting very conscious now of time. I have a few more members, and we are on a time limit for this room. So if I could ask members to keep their questions very brief and to the point, and also the panel to keep the answers similarly brief and to the point, thank you very much. And I'll go then to Jonathan.
Thank you, Chair. And look, this is a serious situation, and the increase of referrals to children's services since last year is extremely worrying for me, and I'm sure the committee. More children are sadly on the child protection register, and that's something that has to be taken into account by not only those in the executive, but indeed wider society, reporting to the harmful impact that the pandemic and indeed the restrictions have had, particularly around schools, workplaces and homes. The welfare of a child is certainly something that must be crucial to the decision-making process. Has the increase in referrals been witnessed across the board? Are there certain trusts disproportionately affected? And what work is the trust doing collectively to maximise staff and share resources across Northern Ireland?
I asked the question about whether or not the increase relates to all trusts. The answer to that is yes. And again, this is information that we can provide to the committee on a trust by trust. But I can say absolutely the increase has been experienced across the board. But one thing that I haven't actually brought to the attention of committee is that in response to the increase in numbers, one of the things that the department did was to ask other departments to work along with us, and there are five of us involved, to develop what we called a Vulnerable Children and Young People plan. That plan has been consulted on, and we're in the process of looking at the responses to that plan. So I think there'll be the opportunity maybe at a future stage to bring some information to the committee about the plan and what the plan contains. But my expectation is that there will be adjustments made to that plan to take account of some of what has been said in response to consultation, because I expect that some people will have some very firm ideas about how we can actually support some of these very vulnerable children.
Okay, thank you.
I'll just answer the second question. Yep. Just to say, the directors of children's services, Jonathan, meets on a weekly basis during this pandemic. We share a lot of knowledge, resources, information. We have a joint action plan that all the social workers right throughout children's services use in relation to how they prioritise services, et cetera, et cetera. We have created a lot more of regional facilities that we use right throughout, and everybody has access to. We have the psychological therapies for looked after children that we're working on together. So there's a lot of cross working right across trust, and we've, for the first time this year, we've done a Northern Ireland wide recruitment of social workers as well. So, and we've helped each other out in relation to that. So a lot of that cross working going on.
Thank you. Jerry?
Thanks. If you expand upon your point, I couldn't hear it. I think it was Ailey's got cut out about some pressures being, and not just COVID, I'm assuming that's staff shortages. So if you expand upon that, and I'll go through a couple of quick questions. Has there been any consideration about foster workers being re-designated as key workers? Remote visits, online visits, VoIPAC, I met a few months ago and they were concerned about that not being suitable for many in their organisation and who they represent. And finally, just on the revocation of the regulations, I think it was Ailish said that you want to do it as early as possible. Is that based on the R rate, on the Minister's recommendation? What is the threshold for when these regulations will be revoked? Thanks.
Okay, so I can start with your question about some of the non-COVID pressures, and I specifically referenced unaccompanied and separated asylum-seeking children and young people, and there has been a fairly steep increase in the numbers of those children who have come into Northern Ireland over the course of the last couple of months, and that has just created additional pressures for the system, and we've had to find placement options for those young people, because our regional reception and assessment centre has been operating to capacity, and one of the options being considered at the minute is the establishment of a facility within Deirdre's area within the Western Trust. In terms of the question about whether or not foster carers are key workers, absolutely, foster carers would be key workers for and anywhere that the term key worker applies would apply to foster carers. I think Deirdre has addressed your point about remote visits, but she might want to add to that. And in terms of the revocation of the regulations, you're quite right. I mean, that will be related to what public health advice is available to us at any stage in the future. So if it is suggested that we can go back to business as usual, or the regulation for monitoring itself shows that the regulations are not being relied upon and do not need to be relied upon, then I think we could make a decision on the back of that alone.
Sure, guys, I know we're pressed with time, but just on the issue of the asylum seekers maybe not getting enough, or there's pressure on social work for those community. Can we get something in writing from yourselves, Eilish and Deirdre, on that, just to expand upon that for our benefit?
We absolutely can give you something. There's actually quite a lot being done in that area at the minute to actually respond to some of the pressures that are in place at the minute.
Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you, Eilish and Eilish and Deirdre, for those. Just to point out to members that we have asked for a briefing on the Vulnerable Children and Young People Plan once that consultation response has been collated. So we should be receiving further information on that. So listen, thank you both for your presentation today and for your answers to members' questions. I very much like to welcome your commitment in relation to the monitoring. I think that does provide some assurance to the committee and to the sector and to indeed the vulnerable people involved, and that's welcome. I think it would be good that if we see further extensions, or if hopefully we won't need future potential extensions, but that those be considered on a individual measure basis, that they're not just rolled forward. And also, I welcome your commitment today, and I think the committee will keep an eye on the situation regarding the revocation of these measures as soon as that is practically possible. I think that's something that, and I understand that you have committed to that and that you are conscious of that. So thank you, and good luck in the future with your very, very important work. Thank you. Okay, members, any other comments then members want to make in relation to any of this? We have, yes, go ahead, Jerry.
Just a brief, I know we're kind of rushing through that for the time, but I mean, I suppose it's a comment about there will be revoked when sort of public health is better. I know it's a slightly a paraphrase on what was said there, and I suppose in one level that's fair enough, but another level I think we just need to focus down on that, when that would be. Is it the R rate coming down? Is it, you know, less infection? So no proposals on that, but just a comment. I think we should just keep an eye on that, and when it's safe to do so, obviously we'd need to see these guidelines or regulations revoked, rather than keeping them on for an extra 2 or 3 months when it's not necessary, to be honest.
Yeah, I think that's a valid point. I think we should keep a very, and that's partly why I welcome the monthly monitoring. I think we should keep a very close eye on that situation. This is a particularly vulnerable cohort of young people, and we do need to play our part in terms of protecting them. I do note that the monitoring issue has been addressed. Should we also recommend that, as I mentioned there, but should we put this in writing, that we recommend that future extensions are considered on an issue, a measure by measure basis, rather than, and also to just note the our desire that these would be revoked at the earliest possible opportunity. Are members content with that? And then I'll go to the formal. The formal, yes, go ahead, Pam.
Yeah, just to say that I don't think they got a chance to answer my last week question, which was asking whether they had made any request to the minister for additional resource, and it kind of tags on to your point that you made to them when you spoke about testing and that. I think it is really important that the department look at new novel ways of dealing with this and trying to find a way forward, because the child protection issue is just too important to let it lapse in any way or relax in any way, given that, you know, certainly any form of lockdown is actually, for some children in particular, is very, very dangerous, a very dangerous place for them to be. So I think they do need to be looking at more innovative ways of actually going forward. And I think we can assume that there's going to be more of what we've had in the last number of months for the foreseeable future, and we don't want to see these regulations in it for any longer than they need to be. So I think it's important that they do look at new ways of going forward and looking at what additional resources they need to make it work.
Yeah, and I think that is an important area to keep. They did reference some additional resource and ongoing further recruitment, but I do think that is a significant alternatives should be getting considered on an ongoing basis, and I think we should keep an eye to that as the monitoring reports come through. So If there's no other issues, then can I ask members to formally our formal consideration of this SR? So can I ask members to agree formally that the committee has considered SR 2020/235, the Children's Social Care Coronavirus Temporary Modification of Children's Social Care Amendment Regulations NA 2020, and has no objection to the rule? Are we agreed? Agreed. Thank you, members. Okay, members, moving on, and I have an eye on it. We do need out of this room by 1:30, but in terms of our forward work programme, item 15 there, can I refer members to the draft forward work programme at tab 15.1 of the pack, which includes the list of organisations who have requested to brief the committee. Are members content to note the forward work programme? Yep, members content. Thank you. Can I also refer members then to the list of international academics suggested by RAIS at tab 15.2 of table papers? Are members content that we seek an oral briefing from these academics on test and trace to inform our considerations? Yep, members content. Thank you. Any other business then? Do members have any other business? Jerry?
Thanks, Chair. Just an issue that's been raised with me the last few days. I've been informed that some Belfast healthcare workers are being issued with clamps and penalty notices on their car when they're in and around hospitals and healthcare facilities, certainly in the Belfast area at least. I think that's unfair, and there shouldn't be penalties on any workers, especially healthcare workers who are working through a pandemic. So I would just like to propose that we as a committee write to the Minister to express our concern about that, our opposition to that, and for his department to look at this and try to get the issue resolved as a matter of urgency.
Yeah, and I was concerned actually to see that as well, given that my understanding is that parking charges have been revoked in light of the pressure that staff are under, and I think it is a bit inconsistent if trusts or I'm not sure where the responsibility lies in terms of individual car parks, but I think the Minister and the Department certainly are best placed to explore that. Jonathan?
Thanks, Chair. And I was going to bring this point up myself because I have had it raised, but I think it's absolutely scandalous that on trust sites potentially we have healthcare workers with their vehicles being clamped given the pandemic and the situation that we find ourselves in. I think it's totally unacceptable, and I would support the call to write directly to the Minister to ensure that we have some clarity on this matter and ensure there's a way forward that ensures the continuity right across trust sites.
Thank you, Jonathan. I have Pam, and then we'll come to Orlea, and then I have Alan. Yes, Pam?
Thanks, Chair. Yes, and I would back Jerry's call there as well. And I know it's different in this particular wave because health services have tried to continue. So, and we know that parking is a premium, and the availability is very difficult, especially around the Belfast area. But certainly, I don't agree with healthcare staff having to pay these charges in a pandemic or out of a pandemic. But I think, yeah, it's additional stress that really our healthcare workers should not be facing at this time. I think it's really terrible that, you know, the idea of coming out of a long shift, of doing such good work, looking after us all, and facing a clamp on your car, it's horrendous. So I'd back Jerry's call for that as well.
Absolutely. Thank you, Pam. Or Leah?
Yes, it's just to say that we were made aware of the same issue as well. And I know that, I'm not sure if Pat's still on the line, but Pat Sheehan, he made contact this morning with the department and with Kathy Jack, the Chief Executive of the Belfast Trust, but it would certainly do no harm. Absolutely, I support Jerry and everyone else in the committee, maybe writing off correspondence, because it's just not good enough.
Okay. Thank you. Alan?
Yeah, I would have thought too that a letter, if it is only in the Belfast Trust, which I assume that's what it is up to date, I think we should be firing a letter off as a matter of urgency to the Trust as well, because writing to the Minister is going to kick off a whole process, but I think that we need to get to the centre of this right away. But I wonder if Jerry could maybe share with us if he had been speaking. I saw it on Facebook and it did seem quite disgraceful, but you know, we're maybe sometimes we don't always know the full circumstances and we don't know the number of people that are involved. But I wonder if Jerry could maybe share with us if he had been talking to the unfortunate person who came out to see a clamp, which must be an awful situation, particularly when you finished a shift. But the Has that person challenged it with the authorities in the hospital? And what sort of explanation have they been given? Have they been given an apology? Have they been issued with a fine? And what was the reasons given for the
vehicle being... Well, Alan, I don't want to go into specific cases here, to be quite honest, and I don't want to put a member on the spot in relation to that either. I think the issue generally is of concern to the committee. I think that's how I will approach it. I do agree that the Belfast Trust, given we know that there's been a case there, I think we should write potentially to all the trusts and the minister, just to we copy the letter across to them, to try to head off a similar situation arising elsewhere. So I don't think we should limit it to Belfast, but I think we should copy in the other trusts.
What would worry me, Mr. Chairman, with not knowing the extent of the problem or what excuse the person has been given, is let's say that the car was badly parked, maybe stopping ambulances getting into the ambulance station. I don't know, but. You know, if it were something like that, you know, there would be.
Well, I take it.
Circumstances.
Yeah. I take it that could form part of the response. Go ahead.
A quick response. I know several people, Alan, that have been healthcare workers who have been clamped and an issue with fines. I'm sure other members know more and different people as well. So I know it's happening to more than one individual, and I think it is of concern, and it's effectively another tax on healthcare workers who are trying to keep us safe. So I was proposing, back the sort of the amendment on the minister and the trusts to make them aware and to make our opposition clear, Chair.
Okay, thank you, members. I think that's a useful point to make. So, members, that concludes our meeting today, unless no other business. So, just before we move into closed session to continue our consideration of evidence on the care homes inquiry, our ongoing work in that regard, I would advise that our next meeting will be on Thursday, the 19th of November, at 9:30 a.m. here in the Senate Chamber. So, thank you, members. That's this meeting concluded.
This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Senate Chamber programme signed. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly.